Apa aku yang merusak?
Mas Hakim, kalau butuh laptop, minta Mas Didi. Yang HP.
awal itu mas ya.
Iya pak.
Pak awal itu dua atau
morning, Prof. Rui.
Hello.
Hello.
Morning, Chair Fatima.
Yeah, morning, Prof. How are you?
Quite good, thank you. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, so far so good?
Yeah.
Okay, that is good. So
yeah.
This should be the
advice
webinar so of your program, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. So you just give a opening remark.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, I know. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So names. You mentioned that I still need to give a talk because on next Monday, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I will prepare for that. Sure. No problem.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, you're welcome. Yeah. Okay. So today's the speaker is ours, and who is the second one?
The first one is Prof. Ramesh.
Okay.
Prof. Ramesh is coming from University Malaya.
Okay.
I think actually his specialization is related with material for energy.
Okay.
Full cell, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And the second speaker is coming from our department, Dr. Alwar.
His
specialization is related with the activated carbon,
mm-hmm.
porous material, and okay. Maybe for today's speaking, maybe he will present about the new trend activated carbon based composite for energy application, such as for cracking and also hydrocracking catalytic reaction.
Okay. Yeah. Sure. Okay. Yeah.
So you don't have the meeting you said before that you have
meeting. They changed to another day.
Oh.
They changed to next week. Yeah.
Oh, next week.
Okay. Yeah. Hello. Awa.
Good morning, Prof. Yandong.
Morning. Nice to meet you again.
How are you today?
Quite good. Yeah. So, are you at the University of at home?
Yes, I am.
Okay.
Same with Bu Is Fatima. You are the same department.
Mm-hmm. Okay, in the department. Okay, yeah. So that's the now. So your university provides the long distance course for students, right?
Yeah, right.
Okay. we use both. Some foreign students cannot come, so that we provide the online course. But okay. For Taiwanese, we provide the face-to-face course.
Okay.
So it is a relatively troublesome for us because we need to prepare two different kinds of work.
Okay.
Really nice to meet you again. Yeah.
Yeah, that's fine.
Kirimin di WA aja.
I think next week you will give speak in our department, right?
Yeah. Sure.
With the professor Dr. Titania.
Yeah.
From your university.
Mm-hmm.
She is a lecturer at the Rio University.
Uh-huh.
It's about 2.5 hours from Jogja by plane.
Okay. Yeah.
It's quite far from here.
But the use of the webinars actually is quite easy for everyone to learn a lot of knowledge now.
But
the feeling is very different. Yeah.
Yeah, it's
Actually, I prefer this to face-to-face because I can know that the feelings of the audience. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. Sure. Okay.
Also, something for something like a workshop on scientific writing. It is very hard to deliver by online, right?
Yeah. Because the online actually is very easy. Everybody can join, but the I have no idea how much they learn. Sometimes. I'm that to face to face, we can ask if we don't understand, but for web nails, it seems very
difficult.
Yeah.
So do you have a student from Indonesia in your university?
Yes, we are. I have one. Yeah, okay. I have one. Yeah.
Where does it from?
Sorry, forgot. Yeah. He told me that now he is the lecturer of his university, and his university requests him to graduate in 3 years, no longer than 4 years. I told him that it is possible, but he needs to work hard, to finish the work. Yeah. I prefer that's the he can graduate in 3 years. But we have a lot of the undergraduates from Indonesia.
So how do you deal with the research? Because we cannot go to campus, right?
Yeah. So that's the we. Actually, so the only way we can use is for online meetings, online promotion, and everything now is online. So we try to contact some universities, some schools, and the names that their name that's the maybe we can have web nails, and the name tries to get the all his. Interested or high potential students together, and then we can give a talk. But it seems it is the only way now so we can do.
We got it difficult to get to allow a student come in campus because the condition pandemic COVID.
And I learned from our video that now Jakarta is in lockdown, right?
That's right, now it's the block.
Okay. How about your city? Still okay?
Jogja, so far is good, but we have to care.
Okay.
In the condition, we have to use masks everywhere, every time.
Okay.
And when we go to up, we have to use it.
Okay. So it seems that the case in your Jakarta is quite the better than Jakarta, right? Okay. That is good.
Right. Yeah.
Okay, together with us, I think Prof. Ramesh from Malaya. Hello, Prof.
Hello.
Hello. Baik. Can you switch your video on? So.
Okay. Can you see?
Yes. Hello. How are you?
Hi. Selamat pagi.
Ya, selamat pagi.
Selamat pagi, Prof. Rames. Apa kabar?
Kabar baik. Ni hao, Professor Dung.
Ni hao. Quite nice. So that's the, have you ever been to Taiwan?
No, I've friends in China. Heng Gao Xing Ren Chi Ni.
Oh, that's really good. So that's the it is the really nice to
meet you. Yeah. Okay. So it seems that you can speak quite nice Chinese. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm learning. I'm trying to learn Mandarin because my daughter speaks very well. My mother is Chinese.
Oh, okay. Okay. Yeah. So it is good for you to learn different languages and the name when you visit mainland China. It seems quite okay. Everybody will be the good friends as of you. Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's the in Malaysia. So now that the situation is okay or no? My friends that told me that the now that the
it's under
the,
control.
The COVID-19 situation in Malaysia now is quite okay. Yeah.
Yeah, it's very much under control.
Okay, that is good. That is good.
Yeah, in Taiwan is doing not too bad, also, isn't it?
Yeah, no. So Taiwan actually is controlled quite good. Yeah, names so we can do a lot of work. Okay.
Right.
Yeah, and sometimes we only need this to keep the social distance, and names so we don't need this to wear the mask. So right. That is the good thing for us. But the problem for us is that we cannot go above.
Yeah, I think same in Malaysia as well. I think traveling there's a lot of restriction.
Yes. And so I know that's the our government actually is allows Malaysia people to come to Taiwan, but the you need to do the quarantine for 1 week. So it seems quite okay. Usually we need to do 2 weeks quarantine, but for people from Malaysia that they only need to do 1 week. So it is quite good. Yeah.
Okay, Prof. Can we start now?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Very good morning, everybody. Selamat pagi. Ni hao. The Honorable, the visiting professor for our department, Professor Wei Andong, the Honorable, the speaker for today, Professor Insinyur Dr. Ramai Singh from University Malaya and University Technology Brunei, Dr. Awar from Chemistry Department, Universitas Islam Indonesia, ladies and gentlemen, it is happy to have you in this webinar, which is the fourth webinar from Chemistry Department, Universitas Islam Indonesia. And before we start, I may share about our today's program. This webinar is conducted by Chemistry Department, Universitas Islam Indonesia, funded by the World Class Professor Program in conjunction with the Global Engagement Grant of Universitas Islam Indonesia. And today we will highlight about the material for energy and environment research. And as our procurement, we have maybe more than 200 participants registered for this agenda. So before we start this agenda, it is kindly requested to all participants to rename the Zoom account with your name _ institution for us to easier catch your identity. And the second, switch off your microphone during the session unless the moderator or host welcome you to ask questions by direct speaking. And as you can replace your background, please use the virtual background of this event, which has been emailed to you. So we will have a nice photo for our documentation. And last, if you have questions, please write in the chat, which will be open 15 minutes before the speech from the speaker finish. So for today's agenda, we will have two speakers. Professor Insinyur Ramesh Singh from University Malaya and Dr. Alwar PhD from Universitas Islam Indonesia and as moderator we will have Bayu Wiyantoko MSc from Chemistry Department Universitas Islam Indonesia. The background of this agenda is actually the increasing environmental problem and deficiency of the energy have become serious issues and urgently need for being addressed. And to make this issue, the key of development is fabrication of advanced material and functional material for energy and environment. And based on this issue, the dissemination on material research, including the optimization of material synthesis is very important. And even though the situation of pandemic COVID-19 restricted us to have such mobility, but we have an information technology, we have Zoom meetings, so we can share the experience of research from our experts. So chemistry department conducted this webinar. And as the visiting professor from our department is Professor Wi Andong, so we will have a welcoming remark from Prof. Wi Andong. So Prof. Wi, please give your welcoming remark.
Okay. Thank you for your invitations, the professors, the Fatima. Good morning, everyone. Also welcome Professor Ramesh and Professor Ours for today's talk. Ladies and gentlemen, good morning. I'm Rian Dong from Institute of Analytical and Environmental Science at National Tsinghua University. It is my great honor to give this opportunity to give this welcome address at the webinar series, especially the topics that today is material for energy and environment. Material is important nowadays because we can try to cultivate our own material for special purposes. And energy and environment is also the hot issues that nowadays, especially for the UNDP, especially when we know that they have the 17th SDG goals. Energy and environment is one of them. Yeah. So I would like to congratulate the Department of Chemistry, EYI, because this webinar actually is a part of the world-class professor program and global engagement grant. This program actually is very competitive and has to get the support from the MOE Indonesia. Fortunately, EYI got 2 times last year and this year. It means that the EYI actually is quite famous worldwide, especially in this program. So secondly, I would like us to congratulate the professors Fatima, because of her work. So a lot of people have noticed that the EYI has such kind of activity in research on environment and energy. My understanding is that this series of online meeting has attracted more than 800 people to attend. Okay, and this is the third series. During the past 2 webinars, they have a lot of positive feedback and names. It means that this workshop is very successful and a lot of people know EYI and also recognize the function of this program. Actually, it should be highlighted that the main things of this webinar is energy and environment. We know that the energy now is quite important nowadays, no matter in Asia or in Europe, as well as in the US. People would like us to see the usage of the fossil fuel and try to turn into the renewable or sustainable energy. Through the work, people try to develop a lot of the nanomaterial can get the high efficiencies this to convert the natural products that like sunlight, that like biomass into the energy. announced that during the production of energy, they also try to protect an environment. So the topic today actually is very important, especially that today we have these two famous professors, Professor Ramash and Dr. Awos. They are quite famous in the fields of the energy and environment. They will introduce the very interesting nanomaterial for energy and environmental application. I do believe that the cutting edge technologies are also very important in every country, especially can fulfill the requirements of the UN SDG goal. Through this activity, I do believe the EYI, especially in the departments of chemistry, will become one of the hub centers in Indonesia to promote the research on energy and environment, as well as to serve as the hub to link Indonesia to the world. Last but not least, I believe all the attendees will learn knowledge in this cutting edge technology for using nanomaterial for energy and environmental application, especially to solve their own problems in their own country. These webinars would help us to establish the cross academic collaboration between EYI and your university in the area of environment and energy. Wish this event successful and everyone can enjoy the agenda provided from EYI. Okay, and wish you all have a great time during this online meeting. And I do believe that this agenda will significantly contribute to the society community, especially for scientists, research, and postgraduates. Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Prof. Rui, for a very nice remark. So before we move to the main agenda for today, so it is requested to all participants and speakers to switch your video on so the admin can catch your screen for our documentation. So Bapak Ibu, untuk dokumentasi, silakan dinyalakan videonya supaya admin bisa men-screenshot profil Bapak Ibu peserta serta saudara semuanya untuk dokumentasi. Mari dipersilakan, silakan menyalakan video. So please switch your video on for me to screen your profile. Okay, in 3 minutes, please wait. One, two, three. One, two, three. Okay. Admin, is it enough?
Then, Professor. Enough, Professor.
Okay, thank you very much for your participation. Okay, so we will move to the main agenda, and this main agenda will be moderated by Bayu Yantoko MSc. So for Pak Bayu, please, it is your time.
Okay, thank you, Professor Is Fatima, for the opportunity. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good morning to all the participants of the webinar series for material for energy and environment. First of all, let me introduce myself. My name is Bayu Yantoko. I'm the lecturer of the chemistry department, Universitas Islam Indonesia. Today, we will follow the webinar in materials for energy and environment with two honorable speakers. For the first speakers,
Let me shortly brief the curriculum vitae. Okay, for the first speakers, we have Professor Ramesh Singh. Professor Ramesh Singh is the senior professor from University of Malaya and also senior professor from University Teknologi Brunei and the consultant professor for Northwestern Polytechnical University China. For the publication, Professor Ramesh Singh is very active and with a highly index 39, and his research is very applicable in the energy and environmental, especially in the development of the materials. So for Professor Ramesh Singh, you may deliver the presentation in 1 hour, and we will have the question and discussion for 50 minutes in the last. For the all the participants, let me inform that you may deliver the question in the chat box, and we will collect later in the 50 minutes for the discussion with Professor Ramesh. So Professor Ramesh, now the screen is yours.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Moderator. Okay, right. Okay, once again, good morning, everyone. I would like to say thank you to Professor Fatima and the university for inviting me to share some of my my work in this seminar. I will not bore you with too much of theory. I will share what are the work that I have done over the past years, especially in recent years. So I'll share my screen now. Okay, I hope you guys can see the screen.
Yes, Professor.
Okay, right. Okay, so basically, the title of my seminar is Microwave Sintering of Ceramics for Bioapplication. So basically, as the chairperson mentioned, that I'm with the University of Malaya, Malaysia. So currently, I'm on secondment, dipinjamkan ke University Teknologi Brunei as a senior professor since early this year. All right, this is just a brief biography of myself. So I'm actually, my first degree is in mechanical engineering, and subsequently I completed a PhD in advanced material in the UK. I have about 25 years of consulting experience and research. My current position is a senior professor of mechanical and materials engineering. I served also as an associate director with the Engineering Accreditation Department of Malaysia. So I'm quite strong in and knowledgeable in the area of engineering accreditation. I have over 350 scientific publications, completed 75 postgraduate students, 32 of which are PhDs. I'm also a visiting professor in several universities in China. I've received a couple of awards, secured some grants, you know, to do research. I'm fellow of the Academy of Sciences Malaysia and fellow of other engineering institutions such as the Institution of Mechanical Engineers, Institute of Engineers Australia, and so on. I'm a registered chartered engineer, chartered professional engineer, and a professional engineer registered in Malaysia. And my research interests span from materials development, welding processes, powder metallurgy, mechanical behavior of materials, failure analysis, and also engineering education. Okay, just a small short history about University of Malaya. Probably most of you all know UM, but let me just you know, share a little bit about the inception of the university. It started in 1905 as basically as King's King Edward's College of Medicine in Singapore. 1928, Raffles College were formed, and sometime in 1949, both the colleges combined to form University of Malaya Singapore campus. After independence in 1957, Malaysia independence, they decided to have two branch campus, one in Singapore, University of Malaya Singapore branch campus, and University of Malaya Kuala Lumpur branch campus. And as time goes by, a lot of things happen, and sometime in 1962, both the university decided to split. So Singapore at that time decided to call themselves University of Singapore. Today it's known as National University of Singapore, and we retain University of Malaya Kuala Lumpur. So basically we are brothers and sisters with NUS, and we are 115 years old. Okay, UM today, we are quite comprehensive university and research intensive. We have 13 faculties, 2 academics, 3 centers, 3 institutes, many research centers. We have 1 private university under our arm. Current student enrollment, about 15,000 undergraduate, and postgraduate about 11,000. So we are looking at about 27,000 population students. In terms of international student, we have about 3,500 international student. So program-wise, we have 200 over programs being offered in UM. So it's quite comprehensive, and you know, we cover almost all areas. In terms of staff profile, we have a total of 6,000 staff. Out of which about 2,500, they are academic staff, and the rest are support staff, management, and supporting staff. Out of the 2,500 odd number of staff, 10% of the academic staff, they are international staff, and they come from, you know, various countries. Okay, just a little bit about ranking. We are quite active in participating in ranking. And this is the current ranking. For QS World University Ranking 2021, we are ranked 59. For Asia, we are ranked 13. This is the latest 2020. THE Asia 2020, we are 43. And the recent announcement of THE World University Ranking, we retain same position between 300 to 350. Okay, so we are doing not too bad in terms of trying to push research and education as well. So these are some highlights. You know, we receive a lot of funding from the public, from industry, and from government as well, international funding as well. In terms of publication, we quite intensify in terms of meeting the numbers. So last year itself, number of ISI, we published about 2,300 odd papers, Scopus 2,800. Out of these ISI papers, our focus is always on trying to get into tier 1 and tier 2 or Q1, Q2. So very high percentages of our papers are basically in those tiers. So we have, in order to achieve this, the university have put in strategy in terms of KPI, in terms of, you know, getting funding for postgraduate supervision. In order for them to graduate, they will need to meet the ISI requirements and so on. So some of these strategies have been put in place, and it has been very successful in trying to meet the requirements. This just to show in terms of main areas. So out of 27 categories, this is taken from Cyworld data. So we are ranked heavily in 20 areas. Out of these 20 areas, I just highlight those relating to my faculty engineering. As you can see that we are strong in chemical engineering, energy, environmental, and material science as well. of course, we are strong in medicine. Medicine, Faculty of Medicine has always been our rival, and Faculty of Engineering and Medicine, we you can see that we are the torchbearer of the university. So we try our best in order to push the status of the university. In terms of this field-weighted citation impact for five main areas, UM is basically ranked above average, world above average in four main areas, in medicine, engineering, computer science, and physics and astronomy. All right, so we are quite strong, especially in engineering. All right, so I think I will not bore you about UM. For more information, you can always visit our website, and if you need to collaborate with any of my colleagues, you can always contact me and I can put you in touch with my colleagues. Okay, I get into the topic of my presentation. So I just highlight a few areas. I'll touch a little bit about bioceramics, introduction to microwave sintering, and I will focus on two main class of ceramics, that's hydroxyapatite and zirconia, which I'm working on. And then I'll summarize, and there's a short video presentation of the work that I'm involved. Okay, when we look at ceramics, I think most of y'all probably already know, but let me just reiterate what the ceramics is all about. When we talk about bioceramics, there's a lot of classes of ceramics out there, but the focus here is on bioceramics. So the term bio means the material being developed for safe use in a musculoskeleton system in human body. And so these are the type of ceramics that can be used as a replacement. This can be a permanent replacement, or it can be an interim to allow the natural tissue, hard tissues, to heal over time. Okay, these are some useful bioceramics. I've highlighted the main one. So we, some of us, we are familiar with tetragonal zirconia polycrystal or TZP alumina. These are termed as bio-inert. And then we have bioactive ceramics, bioglass and hydroxyapatite, they are bioactive. And we have tricalcium phosphate, which is biodegradable. And the definition is very simple. When we talk about bioactive, this material, they are inert in that sense that they will not react with the host tissue, and they will not basically cause any problem when it is implanted. And then we have bioactive. Bioactive ceramics actually participate in the system, in the healing process, and eventually get absorbed or they become one with the body. And bioglass and hydroxyapatite are very good example of those classes of bioactive ceramics. And then we have biodegradable TCP or tricalcium phosphate. Basically, TCP, they are unstable over time and they get resorbed, absorbed into the body. And so, they allow healing to take place. So a lot of time, TCPs are used as scaffolds in order to allow the damaged tissue to heal. And after that, it takes over. Okay, in terms of application, there's a lot listed here, but I just focus on the main area where bioceramics has been used for cranial repair on the skull, maxillofacial reconstruction, when people get involved in accidents, dental implant. So I work in this area with the ceramics, artificial heart valves, orthopedic load bearing application. So we have the, the stem, that is made out of titanium or stainless steel, and we also have zirconia material being used as the head of the stem. The total knee replacement, and of course the calcaneal repair. So in countries like Indonesia, Malaysia, we have a lot of people that actually ride motorbikes, and they get involved in accidents, and they damage their calcaneal section of their feet, and it requires time to heal, and we need to hold the bone together, and biomaterials are being used to assist in this healing process. Okay, these are some application, typical application where we see bio materials being used, whether it's metallic implant or whether it's ceramic implant or the combination of the two. So, you know, in a typical bone fracture, in order to hold the bone together, we may have a titanium plate being placed in with screws holding the bone in place to allow healing to take place. Or we can have a total hip replacement where we have a metallic stem, can be titanium or stainless steel. And we can have then the femoral head made out of zirconia together with a polymeric material where it forms the acetabular shell. Research have shown that the combination of ceramic head, femoral head with the shell, it actually reduces friction tremendously, or with the combination with a polymeric material. So that's why it's being used as the you know, total hip replacement to assist, especially when people have a pelvic injury and you know, they break their pelvic bone and they need somehow a replacement. So that's where the THR is being used. And of course, dental implant. So this is particularly important for people of you know, senior people, you know, where we tend to lose our tooth. And so the only way in order to restore this is to put in an implant. And this is where ceramic plays a big part. And of course, we have in combination with the dental, with the metallic stem, but the abutment, most of the time it is made out of ceramics, okay? And the other one is the internal fixation for calcaneal fracture. You know, when in a motorbike accident, typically people would break the bone at this area, and we have biometallic plates being used with screws in order to hold the bone back in place to allow healing to take place. Part of my research is also looking at developing calcium phosphate glue, a kind of a glue, in order to help to act as an adhesive in order to hold the bone together. So I work with the orthopedic and also the heart surgeons. You know, when they do open heart surgery, so the requirement of the calcium phosphate glue is that they have to set over a certain period of time. So it's not immediate setting. So that's the biggest challenge, in order to see how we can control the time of setting for the glue. So they normally want it to be hardened within 24 hours to 48 hours, just in case if there is a complication and they have to go in again for surgery, and then they have to cut up the rib cage again. So they don't want to do that. So therefore, there must be a time for the setting. Okay, there are many ways how these materials can be processed, and we can categorize them in two main categories. So the on one hand, it is through the heating through thermal conduction, radiation or convection. We can use laser heating, plasma heating, electric heating, infrared or UV heating. So all this type of heating depends really on the three modes: the thermal conduction, radiation, or convection. Then there's the other category, which I put them together: the induction heating, radio frequency, and microwave. Radio frequency and microwave, they are dielectric heating. So this would depend on the material itself to absorb the microwave or the RF, and you have volumetric heating taking place. Okay, why microwave? So why we consider microwave as the energy source for processing of materials? So basically, I've summarized them as SERVs, microwave SERVs. So it saves energy, it is effective, it is rapid, it's versatile, it's economic, and it allows selective heating. All right, so I'll just highlight an example of each. In terms of saving energy, I think there's a lot of literature out there that actually done a lot of studies to compare the effect of conventional processing versus microwave. All right, so these are some typical data that I've taken from literatures. What we can see is that, you know, there is a lot of energy saving in terms of comparing microwave, whether it's for sintering or whether it's for drying. It does not matter, but there's huge saving. Most of the time, it is more than 50% savings. Okay, so as compared to conventional. Okay, the microwave, it is also a rapid process in that sense that we can raise the temperature as high to whatever temperature we want within minutes rather than in hours if we compare conventional heating. Because conventional heating depends strongly on convection, the radiation mode and conduction mode. So it has to transfer heat energy from the outside surface to inside. It takes time. But not with microwave, in fraction of minutes, we can reach up to whatever desired temperature. But again, having said that, it would depend on the materials itself. Some materials couple microwave very quickly at low temperature. Some material couple microwave at higher temperature. All right, so this is an example of hydroxyapatite. Hydroxyapatite able to couple microwave very quickly within minutes, and the temperature can rise very quickly as well. Okay, it is also a rapid process. Microwave can be used for drying. In the industry, this is where the main application of microwave they use for drying processes. And you know, with food processing, especially moisture is very important. Microwave allows that exact control of the amount of moisture to remain in the food during processing. And this can be done in minutes, in a fraction of minutes, rather than using the conventional method where it's very difficult to control the drying process. Okay, so in industry, when it comes to working with powders, mixing and drying together, it saves time, creates more consistent mix for powders, grains, even for pharmaceutical and chemical application. Okay, so this is another just a comparison. Between the productivity versus the savings in terms of processing various ceramics using conventional and microwave. So we can see a lot of savings can be achieved and there's a lot of productivity improvement in that sense. Okay, application of microwave is quite versatile. It started, it's not new. It started in 1940 as for communication purposes. And then in the 1950s to 60s, it has been used for rubber curing and vulcanization, food processing, and so on. And then for low temperature application, 1960s, that's when microwave has been explored for biochemistry, for medical treatment. Between 70s and 80s, that's when microwave has been considered for ceramic processing. So for synthesis, calcination, even joining for coating purposes and for sintering. So it's during this period where a lot of research has been focused, and that's why a lot of the classical papers for ceramic processing comes from this era, 1970s to 80s. In the 1990s, it has been expanded for different areas. Initially, the focus was for oxide ceramics. Then it then got expanded for non-oxide ceramics and glasses. And then in the 2000s, metallic materials were being explored using microwave technology. And currently, there are a lot of experiments and research being done in looking at how to incorporate microwave heating for a variety of other applications, such as recycling of used tires for coal pretreatment, production of biodiesel. There's also work done looking at hybrid multi-energy processing, microwave versus plasma, microwave and laser, and then even microwave, laser, and plasma. So all these are being done, but it's all at the research stage. So versatility of microwave application is appropriate for materials that they are neither, don't require the material to be perfect electrical conductors nor perfect electrical insulators. All right, so they can be explored, but of course it needs work to be done because we we faced in our lab when we process some materials, we have hotspots, we have thermal overrun and so on. So we need to look at how we can facilitate the sintering or the processing of the material. By either doing some pre-heating first before microwave and so on. So research have to be done in order to evaluate that the material able to sustain microwave without showing any cracking and so on. Okay, in terms of economic, we know that if we save energy, we are able to basically also save money in that sense. This data is extracted from the Ontario Energy Agency in Canada, comparing microwave versus conventional for drying, microwave drying, conventional drying, and we have firing, for example, for brick tile. If we compare the conventional firing and drying versus microwave firing and drying, we see there is a total, the substantial total of savings. And I just took the tariff for electricity as of 1st January. This is for Malaysia. And you can see huge saving. And I converted into US dollars. So yearly, there's we are talking about millions of savings in terms of energy. All right. So it gives more motivation why microwave should be considered for processing, for material processing. And of course, selective heating as well. There's a lot of work being done in terms of trying to use microwave to selective heat a certain part of a material, so that it will not affect the other section. And this can be done very rapidly if we can incorporate materials that can absorb microwave. And as microwave pass through, for example, on the left figure shows microwave selective heating. If we have activated carbon with, for example, with a catalyst, and it actually heats up rapidly, and it allows the catalytic conversion or process to take place in a very rapid manner in comparison to conventional heating, where you would have to heat the whole system in order to allow chemical reaction to take place. And of course, studies have shown that there are huge savings in terms of comparing selective heating versus conventional heating. Okay, I think the mechanism, most of y'all know that if we compare conventional versus microwave, conventional is basically heat transfer from outside to inside. And it would depend on the ability of the material to actually transmit the energy. In terms of microwave, it's volumetric. So it's inside to outside, all right? So basically, because of volumetric heating, you are able to control, you can get uniform temperature gradient. Here, you will probably not have a temperature gradient. Here, you will have a temperature gradient. Where the temperature on the outer surface would be high, as it goes inside will be lower. All right, so this causes uneven for ceramic, uneven grain growth, and also sometimes some material would exhibit cracking upon sintering, because you have a case hardening taking place. You have a core that is soft, and you have a shell that is very hard. All right, but with microwave, this can be prevented, because you have uniform temperature across the inside to the outside, and therefore you are able to achieve uniform temperature distribution and rapid heating as well. All right, so these are the advantages of microwave. So it saves time, it actually saves energy, because you don't need a lot of energy in order to get the material heated up to the required temperature. You can get uniform heating with special design, with insulation. And of course, sometimes we need to use susceptors. As mentioned, that the success of microwave heating would depend on the ability of the material to couple microwave. And sometimes we find in our research that having susceptors, silicon carbide susceptors, placed within the vicinity of the sample, it helps a lot for the material to couple microwave as the temperature increases. Ability to achieve high temperature. Even with the household microwave, we have achieved very high temperature with using just the normal microwave for powder processing. But it requires very well insulation being placed around the sample when we microwave using the household microwave. One of the main thing with processing of ceramics is to control the grain or the microstructure. And microwave allows the production of very fine microstructure. And as we are able to control microstructure, we are able to get very good mechanical properties. We are able to avoid cracking, micro-cracking, and so on. So quality of product is assured. And it also helps with nanopowder processing, because if we can process our material faster, that will avoid grain coarsening. And that's when where microwave comes in, and it assists in the nanopowder processing. And of course, selective heating can use for brazing, joining, and it's eco-friendly as well. All right, so it fits very well with SDG goals, as mentioned by Prof. Doom just now. I work in this area because all my research, the main target is always on environmental sustainability, as well as trying to keep the processing costs as low as possible. So basically, I mean, the advantages, it's better, faster, cheaper, and greener. Okay, these are some examples where microwave processing of ceramics can actually produce transparent ceramic. These are very difficult ceramic to be sintered. So this is courtesy of my collaborator, Professor Dinesh Agrawal of Penn State. He has done a lot of work. He's one of the pioneer in this field. And he has produced ceramics that densify to almost 100% theoretical density, and they become transparent in that sense. So for spinal, alumina, nitride, even hydroxyapatite. Okay, let me just highlight the two areas that I want to share with you guys. One is on the hydroxyapatite. Okay, with hydroxyapatite, as you know, that these are calcium phosphate based ceramic. The main constituent is calcium and phosphorus. And because of its main constituent, calcium and phosphorus, it's very similar to our heart tissue. So it is bioactive. It can be accepted in our human body easily without any problem. And then we also have this tetragonal zirconia polycrystal, or TZ. This is a class of zirconia ceramics that exhibit very superior, very good mechanical properties, so much so that early days it has been termed as ceramic steel. Okay, it can be used for mechanical application as well as for clinical application. So this TZ or zirconia, they are actually bio-inert. So HA is bioactive, TZ, it's bio-inert. All right, so I mentioned about bio-inert and bio-active. Okay, what we have done is in order to preserve the environment, and we also look at ways of how we can avoid using harsh chemical. Early days, we use chemicals to make the material, but as we progresses, we also look at using waste material. So I work with eggshells, and the other one is bovine bone and chicken bone as well. So we have processed this in the lab. We take the eggshell. This eggshell is predominantly calcium carbonate, and we are able to process them in order to obtain calcium oxide. And through chemical assisted and microwave processing, we are able to produce nano hydroxyapatite powder. And this powder then can be used for a host of application, either as coating or as implant, solid implant material, or even to make porous scaffolds. And we have done a lot of work to verify the biocompatibility of this material. So this is just an X-ray diffraction showing the microwave processed powder. As you can see, they are nano rods versus human tooth. So this is actually my wisdom tooth that I extracted, not for the purpose of research, but so happened at that time I had a problem with my wisdom tooth. And so I got it extracted, and instead of throwing it away, I at that time in pain, I thought about it. I could probably check what's the X-ray of the enamel so that I can compare it with my material. So we polished the section and we run X-ray. And what you can see here is that the signature shows very compatible. I mean, between the enamel of a human tooth and the powder that we produce in our lab. We have also done some studies, implant in rabbit, in a tibia of a rabbit. This is done by my medical colleague. As you can see that this part here is the implant that we put in. And after 6 months, we sacrificed the rabbit, and this is a microstructure. And as you can see, very good bonding between the bone, the marrows, and the hydroxyapatite, okay, that we produced in our lab. Okay, these are the comparison of properties of the hydroxyapatite that we produced with enamel and bone. And basically you can see that, you know, the density is slightly higher in comparison to enamel and bone, because our bone, our heart tissues are basically, they are not dense, but they have some amount of porosity to allow, you know, the ingrowth of the soft tissues and so on. But with hydroxyapatite, this is a dense body, but we can also process it to become porous, okay, for it to be porous. In terms of strength, we can control the porosity. We are able to control its compressive, bending, tensile. Its Young's modulus is slightly on the high side. It can go up to a fully dense hydroxyapatite, can reach up to about 120 gigapascal as compared to bone, which is 22. So this is where, when we come to designing of the ceramic implant, we will need to consider this, because you know, having a very high elastic modulus would defeat the healing process in the body. So therefore, we don't want the implant to carry all the load and not allowing the heart tissue or the bone to basically heal. All right, so there will always be a requirement to look at the design to ensure that we are able to ensure, if the purpose is to allow healing to take place, then eventually we don't want to have a very high elastic modulus. Okay, so these are just comparison in terms of bulk density. As you can see, this is conventional heating. The conventional heating typically requires slow heating, about 2°C/min to 5°C/min, go up to whatever temperature you want and hold it for 2 hours and cool down. So this is the conventional method of processing ceramics for especially bio hydroxyapatite. Now, in comparison with microwave, we could do it within 30 minutes. Okay, and for every temperature, the whole process finish in 30 minutes, and we can shut off the microwave furnace. And after 1 hour, we are able to remove the samples. All right, in comparison to conventional processing, it takes 24 hours. So you put it in the furnace today, this morning, you only can remove it the next day. But the most important thing is that if we look at the grain size later we'll see, you get very large grains with the conventional heating. Okay, this is the time, as mentioned, if we compare microwave sintering versus the density, the time taken to achieve a particular density. As you can see, at 1000, it's only 29 minutes. It takes 29 minutes to achieve a density of 90%. As compared to 96%, of course, that's about 6% higher, but it takes longer time. You know, a fraction of half an hour versus 1000. 1,000 minutes. And for you to get 98%, 98% dense, it's only 35 minutes. All right, in compare to 1,000 odd minutes with conventional heating. All right, this is the comparison of the microstructure. What is important is if you look at the scale, if you take, for example, 1250 sintering, if you look at this scale, it's 10 microns. This is conventional processed at 1250, and this is microwave processed. So here you can see in a fraction of 1 to 2 microns, this is, you are looking at about 8 to 10, 12 microns. So a huge difference in the grain size. All right, so we can practically control the microstructure. So likewise, firing at 1300, this one gives a better view. As you can see at 1350, if you look at the scale bar versus 10 microns, as you can see, although it looks like almost the same size, but you know, it's the scale that tells you. So this is very huge grains. And when we look at the mechanical the grain size, you see a four-fold increase at 1300 as compared to about nine microns for conventional processing. Now, this has a huge impact in terms of the mechanical properties because microwave processed material, if the grain size is small, we normally have better mechanical properties. Okay, in terms of zirconia exists in three different phases, the monoclinic, tetragonal, and cubic. This is pure zirconia. And on heating, it transformed from the room temperature monoclinic form to tetragonal and cubic. And on cooling, we have the reverse transformation. All right. And one of the issues with pure zirconia is that on heating, there's volume shrinkage. On cooling, there is volume expansion, and this causes cracking of the material, all right? And therefore, pure zirconia normally render itself useless for structural or industrial application. And in order to stabilize this material, what is important is to retain the high temperature phase that is either the tetragonal or the cubic. All right, so as mentioned, cracking, because of the reversal transformation, we have volume expansion and upon cooling, we have cracking of the material. And so in order to take advantage of the high temperature phase, especially the tetragonal and cubic, it is common to actually stabilize the material by using selective additives like magnesium oxide, calcium oxide, or yttrium oxide. And this allows the retention of the high temperature phase at room temperature. Okay, and among the stabilizers, yttrium oxide has been widely studied because it allows the retention of a fully tetragonal structure. So the addition of 2.5 to 3 mol% yttrium oxide is sufficient to actually retain the tetragonal structure at room temperature. So the transformation will not take place on cooling. And this gives, when it is in the tetragonal form, it gives the best or the most superior mechanical properties. And subsequently, this material, when stabilized with 2.5 or 3 mol percent yttria, it is known as YTZP or yttria tetragonal zirconia polycrystals. All right, so they have mechanical, superior mechanical properties and chemical inertness and been employed widely in many engineering application and as in biomedical application as well. All right. And the main uniqueness of this material is its ability to undergo phase transformation in the vicinity of a propagating crack. So a phenomenon known as transformation toughening. So it's a self-healing process. So when there is a crack trying to propagate through the ceramic, the energy of that crack will be absorbed by the tetragonal phase and it transforms in that vicinity. And that causes crack arrest. All right. So this just shows the comparison between YTZP with some the counterpart steel. And as you can see that the modulus is very close to steel in the range of 200 gigapascal. We are able to design the ceramic to have a different levels of tensile strength. strength, and fracture toughness is moderate. It's not as high as some of the steel, but generally it's moderate. It can go between 5 to 10, although higher than 10 has been reported as well. Right, this is just the you know, the mechanism of transformation toughening. So it actually shows in as a crack try to propagate through the material, the vicinity, the energy from this crack will be absorbed by the tetragonal particle and transform. And because we know that the transformation is assisted by volume expansion, and therefore it presses and close up the crack. And there are evidence being submitted in the literature to show the how strong the material is. So this is a microstructure showing a Vickers indentation. And for those who are familiar with the Vickers indentation, normally we would see cracks animating from the corners. In this case, we don't see the crack, and the load that is being used on this material is 100 kilogram force. And I know this because this was part of my PhD work some time ago. And we can see that, you know, the bulging effect through the Nomaski interference, we can see the transformation induce, you know, the phase transformation, there's a surface uplift because the material is so strong, and the only way for the monoclinic phase to actually move is upwards. And so it produce up into the up from the surface. Okay, so we have also done microwave sintering of zirconia and alumina as well. So this is just some of the results to show the effect. As we can see, less than 10 minutes, we are able to get at very low temperature, 1200, we are able to get 96% dense. In order to get a similar density, we would probably go in the region of 1400 in order to get that. So, as earlier I talked about economical, less energy is being used. So therefore it's economical, 10 minutes versus a period of couple of hours in the conventional sintering. So it's rapid as well. Okay, so we have that. Young's modulus as well, because the microstructure is being refined, we definitely have an improved modulus of elasticity or elastic modulus, especially at low temperature. The main problem with processing of ceramics is always trying to achieve high densification, good mechanical properties at low temperature. It is very common to sinter ceramic at very high temperature, like for example, alumina. Alumina are sintered away in excess 1500, but if you look at the grain size, it is very excessive. It's very large, and because of that, we always have lower mechanical properties. So the challenge is always trying to keep temperature as low as possible, at the same time, improve the densification and the properties. And microwave allows us to actually achieve that. All right, so hardness, so you know, it goes without saying, improvement in the properties. All right, so this is a solid oxide fuel cell. This is a cubic zirconia that one of my PhD students worked on. And basically we can see in comparison with microwave, the focus is really at low temperature to produce this cubic zirconia. And we're able to obtain very fine grain size at very high densification. Okay, so the other aspect of work that we have done is to compare doping effect. You see, in my work, we objective is try to keep the process economical. So we tried, of course, with microwave. We also tried with conventional sintering. We tried to lower the temperature by using additives, low temperature additives. And copper oxide, transition metal oxide especially, that is copper oxide or manganese oxide. This material able to assist in the consolidation of the material at very low temperature. Now, this is just an example. This line here, this shows undoped zirconia. Now, the focus is always at low temperature region. So obviously, if we take a YTZP and we sinter at 1100, we are not going to get anywhere. We only going to get in the fraction of 60% dense. But with copper oxide doping, we see a huge improvement from about 57% right up to 70%. But when we couple this with microwave, okay, we went from 70 to 95. So having doping and microwave, we couple them together, we are able to enhance the densification of the ceramic at very low temperature at 1100, right up to 95%. Of course, when we go to higher temperature, it defeats the purpose of using microwave. So when we use microwave, when microwave has been is the target, the focus is at low temperature region, because that's when we get the maximum benefit of economical, rapid, fast, and superior properties. All right, and it goes without saying, we look at the grain size. Of course, at 57, you would get high porosity. And as the undope, when we microwave, it goes up to about 77%. So this is microwave undope, but this one is with copper oxide doping. So you get 95% and grains, very small grain size, less than 0.1 micron. Okay, and likewise with mechanical properties, we see improvement with mechanical properties as well as compared to microwave sintering. But what we find is that once we go to higher temperature region, it defeats the purpose of using microwave. Likewise for toughness, can see with copper oxide coupled with microwave, we have very good improvement in the toughness. Okay, so when we talk about application, zirconia hydroxyapatite, they are used for a variety of application. So these are some for grinding media, for sleeves, for seal rings, you know, and of course the femoral heads for the zirconia implant. So this is something that I've made long time ago when I was working in the in another company. So we made zirconia cutting tools. So this is a cutting tool that I've made for industry as well. So these are very small cutting tools. They are in the region of less than 5 millimeter, and there's a countersunk inside. And these are used for semiconductor cutting. And so this, it shows that, you know, we can actually near net shape zirconia to any shape we want through powder compaction. So basically I did not use any special technique. It is through powder compaction and microwave sintering. We are able to produce a cutting tool without any cracking and so on. And of course, yeah, dental implant. This is something that if we don't look after our tooth at some point in our life, we will lose our tooth and you know, we probably would need to have a replacement. And thanks to, you know, with technology and with materials like hydroxyapatite and zirconia, we are able to, you know, replace this. But of course, it's a painful procedure that we have to go through, but it serves the purpose. Okay, we can use it either as crown or as a solid tooth, a solid implant. Of course, the inside would have been a metallic implant. And I worked with one company as a consultant in Thailand, and they produce the cutting tools, the drill bits, to actually make the recess inside the jawbone, okay, in order to put the implant in. And now the company is expanding in trying to make the implant itself. All right, so this is the other work that I'm working with this company in Thailand. So they are looking at trying to produce, you know, control porous scaffold. This is made out of zirconia through 3D printing. So basically it shows, this is an example how the microstructure, as you can see, we can control the pore distribution. And this is made out of zirconia. We can also produce this out of hydroxyapatite. These are the various drill bits that the company is producing. So these are used basically for dental application. So these are the stainless steel or titanium drill bits. So these are the replica of the metallic tools. All right, these are some of the tools that I have consulted on. All right, so in summary, microwave serves saves energy, effective, rapid, versatility, very versatile and flexible. It is an economic process and it allows selective heating. Okay, so thank you very much for listening to my talk. I'll end with a short presentation, all right, of zirconia implant. Just give me a minute. Let me share the. Okay, I hope you guys can see this. Enjoy the video. Okay, that's all. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Professor Rames, for the interesting presentation and also the video at the end of the presentation. Okay, the next is for the Q&A. We have already a question for Professor Rames. Let me share the... Maybe, sorry, Professor Rames, maybe you can stop share screen first. Okay. Thank you, Professor. Okay, Professor Rames, we have a question from Professor Isfatima. There are two questions. The first is, how about the combination of titanium oxide and hydroxyapatite? Do you have any experience on this combination? And the second is, maybe you want to answer the first question first?
Yeah, okay. For combination of TiO2 and HA, we have not done a study on that. We have done a study on combination of zirconia and hydroxyapatite. And we found that with the combination of any combination, hydroxyapatite is a bit sensitive when it comes to doping. It does not go well with many combination. With zirconia, we found that it creates a lot of porosity. And of course, there's a lot of parameters that we need to control. And I would think that with titanium oxide doping with hydroxyapatite, you would also face some issue because hydroxyapatite phase is very sensitive. In order to, when you have a doping effect, there will be a HA phase transformation to alpha TCP or beta TCP and sometimes TTCP or even calcium oxide. So this is something that you will have to play around in your experiments in order to find what would be the optimum condition, how much of titanium you can add, and what would be the processing condition. So hydroxyapatite is sensitive in that sense. In comparison to zirconia, zirconia is a low amount of dopants they can tolerate, but high amount of dopants can also be an issue, but they are not as sensitive as hydroxyapatite. I hope I've explained, answered your question, Prof. Fatima.
Okay. Thank you, Professor Rames. And for the second question is, how is the eco technology aspect of microwave process compared to usual process like heating, reflux, and so on?
Okay, I think generally, having said all the good things about microwave, I think initial capital cost for equipment can be on the high side. Early days, there was an issue of uneven heating, but that they have solved through stirring mechanism. So now they are able to control the microwave energy surrounding the component. But on a long-term perspective, microwave, when we look at the amount of energy savings and the sustainability of the technology itself, then it is viable. But of course, the initial capital cost is always high with microwave technology. Even the furnace that I have in my lab, it's a 6 kilowatt furnace. We got it for, I can't recall the exact price, but it's not cheap. It's not cheap. But of course, when we compare to the savings that we have, we will achieve when we do the break-even analysis, then you see that within 12 months to 18 months, we are looking at break-even. And thereafter, you can reap the benefit of microwave. Even in industry, you can talk to many people who have done drying using microwave. The break-even period, where you will see the return on investment, it's between 12 months to 18 months.
Okay, thank you, Professor Rames. We have still collected the question. And for the
The next question is from, let me summarize first.
Sure.
Maybe please be patient, Professor Ramesh. From, let me share screen. Okay. This is the, okay. Okay, the next question is from Silvana Dewi from UPN Veteran East Java. Is it possible the energy from microwave could change the crystal structure of the perovskite oxide or ceramic, especially the space group during the synthesis process?
Okay, it depends. If you are using it for heating process by controlling temperature, you may not cause any phase changes. But if the objective is to induce phase changes, because with ceramics, as we know that that high temperature, when we exceed a certain threshold temperature point, then we will see a phase change. So with microwave, you are able to control the power. So meaning that you are able to control precisely the temperature. You are able to control the holding time, and that could allow you to decide if you want phase change to take place or not to take place.
Okay.
So that's why in my talk I talk about versatile. It is flexible and versatile.
Okay. The next question is from DC. In European, there is strong connection between government, industry, and university. How about those connection in your respective country? How much of the research made into industry to be commercially marketed?
Okay, that's, I think, a very good question. I do agree with that question. In Europe, even in the US, we see very strong collaboration between the government, industry, and university. In our context in Malaysia, we have a collaboration, especially with my faculty. I was the former deputy dean research for the Faculty of Engineering, and we try to match our researchers, our work with industry, and of course there is a support from government. We have the Ministry of Education and Ministry of Science and Technology that provide funding. We also have venture capital that supports the commercialization as well, but there's always a gap between what industry wants and what the university wants. And I think the biggest issue is sometimes, it goes back to the focus of the university and the focus of the industry. Of course, we know that industry, they look at the commercialization, dollars and cents. In the university, it's about developing, harnessing knowledge, developing talents, doing research, sometimes for ranking purposes, and of course to support industry as well. But again, we have multi-focus and multi-task, so it's always difficult to meet the industry demand, and industry wants it, yesterday. Whenever there's a problem, they want the solution yesterday, so they want it quick, and their output is about solving their problem rather than we as academic looking at ways of how to publish the results. When we see something nice, we want to understand the phenomenon. So there's always this mismatch between what industry and university wants. But again, there's a lot of effort in Malaysia context. We are trying to bring some of our research, not all. Fundamental research is still very important. We cannot detach fundamental research from academic. We need that research to build understanding, but of course there are moves to take some of our research to commercialization, and we have been very successful in some areas in trying to commercial some of our product, and I think this is still an ongoing effort, but we don't see very much a lot of research done at the university that is taken to the marketplace. Again, in order to do this, then we have to relook at the whole ecosystem. It's not just looking at just what the university wants, but we have to see also how we can position ourselves in order to take research or do commercial research and transform it into product and able to commercialize it. So it's always a issue that we will have to tackle. But certainly, as far as Malaysia is concerned, we are doing our best in trying to meet both demands, the university, as well as industry. All right, so, and of course, a lot of promotion needs to be done in order to promote the expertise of our academic staff. So sometimes the industry, they don't know what are the expertise available in the university. And there's no platform, or even if there's a platform, you know, academic always find difficulty in trying to connect with industry in order to find the industry player to come on the same table and discuss. So there must be some form of, you know, conduit that allows these two parties to actually understand each other's problem and see how they can work together.
Okay, Professor Rames, thank you for the answer. I think we all do agree for the third question that have responded by Professor Rames. We have faced the same problem when the product of the research from the university that can be applicated in the industry, there is still a wide gap between the industry and the university itself. Okay, we still have time for the participant that have a question, maybe can directly ask to Professor Rames. Maybe I have one question for Professor Rames for regarding the first question actually that Professor Is has already submitted. So the best doping so far that Professor Rames has been doing for hydroxyapatite for the metal oxide is zirconia, right? Or
Manganese oxide so far seems to be you know, well accepted by hydroxyapatite.
Oh, okay.
Manganese oxide, yeah.
Manganese oxide. Okay. So how about the other application? Maybe can the hydroxyapatite itself can be used in other application, like in the for the catalyst itself, maybe if it given with the doping itself, Professor?
Basically, HA, because of its properties, it's widely used as either coating material or as implant because of its calcium phosphate combination. So it gives, you know, it resembles bones very well. There are some work being done in using the HA as a kind of like a fertilizer, but I've not explored that area. But most of the time, it is widely used as for bio application purposes.
Okay, bio application so far. Yeah. Okay. I think there is no other question for the session. I will deliver the many thank you for Professor Rames for the interesting presentation and also the video. Maybe we can go to the next presenter. We have already another outstanding presenter. Let me share the... Dr. Alwar. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Good morning, Dr. Alwar.
Good morning.
Okay. How are you today, sir?
Alhamdulillah, very fine. Good.
Okay. Dr. Alwar, maybe let me introduce Dr. Alwar is a lecturer in the chemistry department, Universitas Islam Indonesia. Dr. Alwar focusly on the carbon active, especially maybe recently in the composite of the carbon active. The same as Professor Rames, Dr. Alwar may deliver the presentation for 1 hour. We will have the discussion maybe 15 or up to 20 minutes in the end of the session. So the presentation is ready. The screen is.
Okay, wait. Can you see my
my slide?
Okay. The slide is clear, Dr. Alvar. You may please. Okay.
Okay.
You may
can she make my slide?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
You may slideshow Dr. Alvar with the full screen.
Full screen.
Okay.
Okay, now can you see that? My slide?
No, sir.
No?
No.
How about this? Not full.
Okay, yeah, but for the full screen, Dr. Alvar, maybe.
Okay.
Kanan bawah
ini Pak.
Ini Pak.
Kanan bawah itu ada slideshow.
Nah, ya.
Nah, betul, itu. Pak. Kurang dikit.
Ke bawah dikit, Pak. Ada. Mana?
Bisa. Okay. Yeah. Thank you Mr. Bayu. As a moderator. Okay, can you see that my slide?
Okay, clear, sir.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi
wabarakatuh. Alhamdulillah, wa syukurillah, la haula wa la quwwata illa billah. Thank you very much, Mr. Bayu, as the moderator. This time, I would like thank you very much to all the participants. I'm going to talk about the new performance of the adiabatic carbon nano composite of the nickel oxide and copper oxide adiabatic carbon for the hydrocracking process. Mr. Bayu, I want to ask you, I see from the slide all the participants are from Indonesia. So do you mind if I speak Indonesia or I have to speak in English?
You may deliver in Indonesia, sir.
Okay, thank you very much. Because I saw that all the participants are from Indonesia except Prof. Ramesh and Prof. Riandong.
Yeah,
that's right. Okay, I would like to saya ingin menceritakan sedikit tentang sejarah Universitas Islam Indonesia. Universitas Islam Indonesia itu didirikan pada 8 Juli 1945. Ya, jadi 40 hari sebelum Republik Indonesia merdeka, tepatnya di Jakarta, dengan nama Sekolah Tinggi Islam, dengan nama Sekolah Tinggi Islam atau Islamic Higher School. Kemudian ketika pindah ke Jogja, Sekolah Tinggi Islam itu diganti namanya menjadi Universitas Islam Indonesia. Dan UII, singkatan dari Universitas Indonesia, merupakan salah satu perguruan tinggi tertua di Indonesia. Pendiri dari UII itu adalah Dr. Satiman, Kiai Haji Abdul Wahab, dan beberapa yang lainnya, termasuk Dr. Muhammad Hatta, Vice President, the first Vice President of Indonesia. Jadi ini adalah pendiri dari Universitas Indonesia. Kemudian beranjak ke berikutnya, ya, pada tahun 2020 ini kita melihat gambar pertama ini, ya. Ini adalah boulevard, ya, boulevard. Ini adalah boulevard dari apabila ada tamu dari luar datang ke Indonesia atau datang ke UII, maka dia selalu melewati jalan depan ini boulevard UII. Kemudian di samping boulevard itu ada library. Ya, yeah, very nice library. Ya, yeah, library ini ada apa namanya ini candi. Candi Kimpul. Ya, yeah, jadi dikelilingi oleh perpustakaan ini. Jadi ini candi, very nice candi ya, temple di mana tidak di candi ini terdapat patung Ganesha. Ya, patung Ganesha. Jadi real Ganesha ditemukan lebih kurang 4 meter di atas permukaan tanah pada waktu itu. Dan di bawah Ganesha itu ada stempel yang terbuat dari emas yang menyerupai lambang UGM, menyerupai, tapi tidak seperti lambang UGM, menyerupai. Nah, ini adalah gedung-gedung FMIPA. Jadi FMIPA ini sangat romantis ini. Ya, dikelilingi oleh bunga-bunga ini ya, jadi banyak bunga di gedung FMIPA. Dan kemudian di samping ini ada RSC, jadi Royal Society Chemistry. Jadi prodi kimia, khususnya S1, yang telah terakreditasi A, kemudian juga terakreditasi internasional dari UK. Jadi kalau di Indonesia itu, kalau saya tidak salah, hanya ada 4 atau 5 perguruan tinggi di Indonesia yang prodi, maksud saya, prodi kimia yang terakreditasi internasional. Jadi ada ITB, ada UI, ada UGM, IPB kalau tidak salah, kemudian ada UII. Jadi inilah prodi S1. Alhamdulillah sekarang Fakultas Matematika ini yang prodi kimia telah mendirikan program S2. Jadi sudah tahun kedua ini ya. Jadi kalau kita melihat laboratoriumnya, alhamdulillah laboratorium terpadu Universitas Islam Indonesia ini sudah sangat komplit. Ya, kita punya GCMS, punya SEM, ADX, kita punya HRD, SPLC, NMR, jadi boleh dikatakan ada lagi Foresight Analyzer, GSA, sehingga untuk menerima mahasiswa S2 itu untuk melakukan risetnya insya Allah telah memadai. Dan dalam waktu dekat insya Allah kita akan mendirikan PhD program, ya, program PhD di prodi kimia ini. This is our group material, ya, dari grup material yang kami sama-sama bekerja sama mahasiswa program S2. Oke, okay, for the next, I would like to talk about the nanotechnology. Kita bicara tentang nanotechnology. Lalu orang mengatakan nanoteknologi itu apa? Banyak orang tidak memahaminya, ya. Tapi sekarang alhamdulillah nanoteknologi itu sudah jadi bagian dari hidup kita. Berbicara tentang nanoteknologi, kita bicara tentang material dengan very small scale, like atomic scale, ya. 1×10⁹-9, sangat kecil sekali, ya. Di mana nanoteknologi itu material nano itu dapat digunakan dalam berbagai macam sektor, baik itu automobil, industri, kesehatan, dan banyak lagi komputer, ya. Jadi sangat banyak sekali. Oleh sebab itu karena dream big, jadi kita bermimpi besar, tapi kita start from the small thing, ya, sesuatu yang kecil kita mulai dari yang kecil. Nah, ini sangat menarik sekali nanoteknologi ini, yang insya Allah ini setiap akan meningkat terus ini, akan meningkat terus kebutuhan nanoteknologi ini. Nah, banyak keistimewaan-keistimewaan dalam nanoteknologi. Oke, for the next, I'm going to focus on the active party carbon. Yeah. Everybody maybe know about the active party carbon. Yeah. Jadi, let me see. Yeah. Global active party carbon market size, yeah, was estimate at increase, ya, increase 4.72 billion pada tahun 2015, kemudian menjadi 8,1 US dollar billion 2018, dan pada tahun 2024 itu sampai 10,15 billion dollar. Jadi kebutuhan karbon aktif di dunia itu akan selalu meningkat, ya, karena banyak kebutuhannya. Kemudian kita melihat pada tahun 2020 itu sampai 5,092 kiloton yang akan dibutuhkan, ya. Untuk apa kegunaan karbon aktif? Ya, kebanyakan secara umum adalah sebagai wastewater treatment, ya. Ini kegunaan secara umum. Kita melihat global market-nya, ya, setiap tahun itu akan meningkat terus sampai 2024 akan meningkat terus, steadily increase until 2024. Ya. Kemudian negara-negara yang membutuhkan dominan membutuhkan karbon aktif itu ya seperti Amerika, China, ya, and other country in Asia sangat membutuhkan karbon aktif ini. Kemudian kegunaan dari karbon aktif, ya, seperti kita ketahui, ya, banyak manfaatnya. Di antaranya adalah sebagai wastewater treatment. Jadi wastewater treatment, kemudian juga sebagai food beverage process. Dan wastewater treatment itu digunakan sebagai alat untuk pemisah. Jadi material with nano pores, ya. Jadi pori-porinya sangat kecil sekali, itu digunakan untuk pemisah kontaminan, polutan. Apa saja? Organik, anorganik, polutan. Kemudian food beverage processing bisa untuk menghilangkan color, odor, bau atau warna di dalam makanan, dalam minuman. Itu selalu juga menggunakan karbon aktif, ya. Pharmaceutical and medical ya juga itu sering digunakan, ya, sama seperti menghilangkan bau atau menghilangkan warna di dalam obat-obatan. Bahkan sekarang yang sangat menarik, ya, karbon aktif dapat digunakan sebagai mask untuk wajah, automobile for air purification, ya, kalau kita melihat di air conditioner AC, Neo AC, AC yang baru-baru sekarang itu, mereka telah menggunakan aktivasi karbon, ya, supaya bakteri-bakteri yang dimasuk dari udara itu tersaring dengan baik, tidak sampai kemasuk dalam ruangan. Kemudian banyak lagi yang lain sebenarnya, kegunaan-kegunaan daripada aktivasi karbon itu. Secara umum bahwa kegunaan daripada karbon aktif itu adalah separation and purification process, pemisahan dan pemurnian. Itu secara umum. Yang lain-lainnya baru diikuti sebagai ada yang katalis atau sebagai kapasitor, sebagai sensor, ya, juga banyak digunakan itu. Nah, sekarang mungkin kita bertanya, ya, cakul atau dikatakan dengan arang dan karbon aktif, aktif pada karbon. Meskipun keduanya itu memiliki raw material yang sama. Tetapi proses dan karakternya itu sangat berbeda sekali. Ya, cakul atau arang itu biasanya diproses dengan membakar di area terbuka atau dengan kata lain with limited oxygen content. Sangat sedikit kandungan oksigennya, tapi ada, ya, ada. Sehingga ketika itu dibakar, prosesnya mengeluarkan api, kemudian ketika apinya sudah besar, sebagian itu disiram sama air, ya, supaya tidak menjadi abu materialnya, ya. Sehingga terbentuklah arang atau cakul, ya. Jadi materialnya umpamanya kayu, ya, bambu, wood, ya, bagasi. Kemudian macam-macam, ya, yang bisa juga digunakan karbon aktif. Apa kegunaannya? Kegunaannya sebagai source of energy, ya, sebagai sumber energi yang digunakan untuk membakar. Kayaknya kalau membakar sate, ya, atau untuk media tanaman, kalau rice husk atau sekam padi yang dibakar, itu digunakan sebagai media makanan tanaman. So what is the difference with activated carbon? Activated carbon is very interesting material, ya. The color almost the same with charcoal. Activated carbon and charcoal are black. Yeah, but it's different characteristic. Yeah. Jadi keistimewaan daripada karbon aktif ini, dia memiliki surface area yang sangat besar, sangat luas. Yang pernah saya temukan di dalam suatu riset menggunakan karbon aktif from kernel, palm oil kernel, so I found about 2,400 meter square per gram. Jadi 1 gram karbon aktif itu dengan rata-rata 2,400 meter butir sangkar. Jadi kira-kira berapa itu? 24 meter kali 100 meter. Mungkin separuh 8 bola kaki. 1 gram. Yang 1 gram. Jadi kalau kita buka, dia punya pori-pori, kita ukur, nah lebih kurang seperti itu. Jadi versatile absorbent. Ya. Jadi the characteristic is very, very interesting. Kemudian surface area, kemudian adalah dia punya pori, punya volume, punya surface area fungsi kalian ya. Nah, yang menarik tadi kita katakan surface area ya, yang luasnya sampai 2000 sampai 300 meter square ya per gram, sangat luas sekali ya, yang digunakan sebagai media untuk interaksinya suatu adsorbat dan adsorben, ya. Jadi dia akan berada di surface area, maka semakin luas surface areanya, semakin banyak tempat interaksinya. Sehingga dengan mempelajari surface area, kita mengetahui mekanisme reaksi antara adsorbat sama adsorben. Ya, nanti bisa dipelajari dengan menggunakan kinetik, reaksi kinetik. Akan ada pseudo first order, pseudo second order. Ini akan kita lihat interaksinya, ya. Jadi luas permukaan itu sangat penting sekali. Pore volume ya, itu bagian daripada struktur dari surface area, ada pore volume ya. Kemudian ada pore size distribution. Jadi pore size distribution itu di dalam suatu penelitian itu memang didesain ya, surface area itu memang didesain. Jadi itulah suatu metode yang harus kita lakukan. Kita we have to find the right method to get the high surface area, to get pore size distribution. Jadi kita harus menemukan metode yang benar. Ya, pore size distribution itu dibagi ada tiga, ada micropores, ya micropores, pori-pori yang berukuran mikro, lebih kecil daripada 2 nanometer. Kemudian ada yang 2 sampai 50 nanometer itu meso, dan di atas 50 nanometer kita katakan dia makro. Ya, jadi kalau kita sudah berbicara tentang mikro, maka bakteri itu tidak akan lewat lagi. Ya, bakteri itu tidak akan lewat lagi. Maka itu didesain oleh orang. Kita menginginkan pori yang seperti apa? Maka itu sangat tergantung kepada metode, tergantung kepada raw materialnya. Kemudian very functional group yang menarik itu ya. Jadi activated carbon memiliki bermacam elemen sebagai gugus fungsi yang itu tidak dimiliki oleh semuanya, tidak dimiliki oleh cakul tadi atau arang ya. Jadi gugus fungsi sangat penting untuk interaksinya antara adsorbat sama adsorben. Nah, kadang-kadang kalau kita menggunakan suatu metode menggunakan temperatur yang tinggi, kebanyakan gugus fungsi ini akan rilis ya, the functional group release, sehingga dia akan memiliki gugus fungsi yang terbatas, ya itu. Jadi kita guna metode yang baik. Physical and chemical sorption, ya. Jadi kita bisa melihat interaksi antara adsorbat adsorben. Apakah dia menggunakan physical proses, ya? Mungkin dengan proses van der Waal, ya? Atau dengan chemical proses, ya? Ada suatu reaksi kimia. Ya, ini sangat erat hubungannya dengan menggunakan pore size distribution. Jadi kalau di dalam mikropori monolayer, dia cenderung kepada physical chemical process, ya, chemical sorption. Tetapi kalau sudah meso atau makro, dia cenderung kepada physical sorption. Jadi memang ini didesain, ya, didesain kita harus maunya seperti apa. Nah, sekarang karbon aktif itu dikembangkan lagi menjadi new performance. Saya katakan begitu new performance karena ada suatu kembangan baru sehingga easily modified using metal. Ya, jadi karbon aktif ini direaksikan dengan material lain, umpamanya dengan metal, sehingga dia menjadi suatu komposit. Metalnya menjadi nanopartikel. Ya, nanopartikel metalnya. Jadi komposit nanopartikel. Ini dikembangkan dengan berbagai metode sehingga aplikasinya, kalau yang selama ini karbon aktif digunakan sebagai purification, separation process, now dalam new performance ini aktif partikel karbon itu digunakan untuk katalis, untuk kapasitor, untuk sensor. Nah, ini yang dikembangkan sekarang oleh material science. Oke, aktif partikel karbon, ya, kalau kita melihat dia punya sudah familiar. The structure of the aktif partikel karbon can be separated into three PEC, powder aktif partikel karbon dengan ukuran 5×10⁻⁷, sangat kecil sekali, ya, atau granular aktif partikel karbon yang ukurannya lebih besar antara 0,2 sampai dengan 5 mm. Ada yang pelet, ya, pelet seperti gini. Dan ini menjadi hal yang sangat penting kalau kita dalam mau mendesain aktif partikel karbon atau mendesain new performance of the aktif partikel karbon. Ingin kita buat powder kah atau ingin kita buat granular kah dia? Jadi ini dari awal kita sudah bisa menentukan. Jadi tidak bisa kalau sudah jalan, sudah terbentuk, kemudian baru kita tentukan, maka karakternya akan kurang baik. Nah, coba kita melihat, ya. Ini gugus fungsi, surface functional group merupakan hal yang sangat penting. Di mana di sini adalah core interaction between asorbate, like we say metal, or organic, methylene blue, ya. Itu akan berinteraksi dengan aktif partikel karbon itu disupport oleh adanya gugus fungsi. Sehingga gugus fungsi itu penting. Nah, kita harus pahami, kadang-kadang kalau kita menggunakan proses pembuatan karbon aktif dengan high temperature, pyrolysis with high temperature, ya, temperatur tinggi sampai letakkan 1000 derajat Celsius, we are worried about the surface functional group dismissed. Jadi surface functional group akan hilang. Ya, kalau itu hilang kita harus desain kembali, kita harus menambahkan, ya, kita desain kembali. Ya, jadi kita bisa mendesainnya. Nah, seperti ini bisa dapat N, ya. Ini ada gugus karboksil, lakton, fenol, karbonil dan sebagainya. Ya, jadi ini satu metode contoh mendesain kita akan lihatkan. Ya. Jadi sangat penting. Jadi selain daripada surface area, pore volume, pore size distribution, jangan lupa bahwa surface functional ada hal yang sangat penting sekali. Nah, sekarang saya telah bekerja banyak tentang karbon aktif, mulai dari 2005, ya, saya telah melakukan many raw material dari rice husk, ya, ini rice husk. Kemarin kita coba untuk mengabsorpsi logam-logam berat, sangat bagus sekali, dan kita bisa melihat, menentukan kinetiknya, kita bisa menentukan interaksinya, apakah lamware friendly, kita sangat bagus sekali. Kemudian saya sudah menggunakan dengan tandan kelapa sawit, ya, pelepah, tandan kelapa sawit, ya, juga kita sudah gunakan. Dan kemarin kita juga menggunakan tumpurung kelapa sawit. Nah, kalau saya membandingkan tumpurung kelapa sawit much better than tumpurung kelapa biasa, coconut shell, ya, karena the carbonaceous content of the kernel palm oil much better, ya, yeah, compared to coconut shell. Jadi ini sangat sangat baik sekali, ya. Yeah. Ini kebanyakan tempurung kelapa sawit ini kebanyakan dibuang di sekitar industri, kemudian dibakar untuk menghasilkan sumber energi, ya. Kemudian digunakan untuk industri, termasuk juga pelepah kelapa sawit. Kemudian saya juga sudah menggunakan yang menarik ini, kemarin ini dia punya struktur yang bagus adalah limbah kulit kayu manis. Jadi kulit kayu manis itu setelah diambil minyaknya, maka dia akan jadi limbah. Nah, memang beberapa penelitian menggunakan sebagai pewangi, masih bisa digunakan sebagai pewangi, tapi kita gunakan sebagai karbon aktif. Nah, dia punya struktur yang bagus sekali. Dan begitu juga tandan pisang, ya, tandan pisang ini belum ada yang melakukan, kita juga melakukan, sangat bagus sekali tandan pisang kita buat. Nah, proses pembuatan karbon aktif, ya, yang sudah dilakukan itu dapat dilakukan dengan proses physical process, ya, di mana physical process itu kita membakar dalam ruangan tertutup without any oxygen inside, ya, we can add nitrogen gas, ya, boleh kita tambah dengan itu saja dengan nambah nitrogen. Hanya saja memang physical process need high temperature, ya, kita butuhkan temperatur yang sangat tinggi, mungkin sampai di atas 800 sampai 900 derajat Celsius, ya. Berbeda dengan chemical process, raw materialnya, ya, we have to impregnated with the chemical. Kita mengimpregnasi dulu materi-materialnya dengan menggunakan bahan kimia. Seperti KOH, potassium hydroxide, phosphoric acid, zinc chloride, ya, there are many others chemical that can be used for chemical agent in the chemical process of preparation of the carbon. Jadi, ini sangat 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 menarik, ya. Kalau kita bandingkan, ya, the result antipati karbonnya memang selama ini chemical process much better concerning about the structural antipati karbon. Jadi baik itu surface area, pore volume, pore size distribution, including surface area, ya. Jadi memang lebih baik. Nah, kebanyakan antipati karbon ini digunakan sebagai, ya, seperti tadi, ya, yang katakan sebagai separation and purification process. Jadi, nah, akhir-akhir ini saya lagi tidak menggunakan pyrolysis dengan menggunakan temperatur, tapi temperatur tinggi, tapi kita gunakan dengan hydrothermal. Jadi, suatu penelitian itu memang perlu kita mendesain dengan baik. Kalau umpamanya raw material saya itu berasal dari tempurung kelapa sawit, maka saya dapat menggunakan pyrolysis dengan temperatur yang tinggi. Let me say 800 to 1000 degrees, ya, under nitrogen by chemical process. Tidak jadi masalah kalau tempurung kelapa sawit ini kita gunakan dengan temperatur tinggi. Tetapi kalau kita gunakan cinnamon oil tree waste dengan menggunakan temperatur tinggi, dia akan banyak menjadi abu. Ya, atau letakkanlah tandan pisang, itu akan banyak lebih menjadi abu. Sehingga kita menggunakan dengan hidrotermal proses, ya. Maka karbon kontennya lebih baik. Ya, lebih baik. Nah, itu memang satu hal yang sangat perlu kita desain dengan baik. Kemudian antipati karbon, kemudian barulah kita dari pembentukan antipati karbon ini kita lanjutkan kepada advance antipati karbon. Oke. Secara umum, ya, general characterization of the antipati karbon, kita bisa menggunakan TGA, thermographic analysis, ya. Kita akan mengevaluasi degradasi daripada material itu, ya, karbon aktif itu. Kita melihat dengan temperatur. Jadi kita melihat dari sini, ya, temperaturnya lebih rendah, ya, dan lebih rendah ini akan menguap terlebih dahulu, mungkin kandungan gasnya dalam karbon aktif, liquidnya dalam karbon aktif, bahkan ketika dipanaskan sampai 200 itu dia akan menguap. Bahkan air yang air itu bisa sampai 100 atau 200 derajat Celcius. Kenapa? Karena air itu terkurung di dalam pori-pori sehingga dia need high temperature to release. Ya, sampai pada 200, ya, sampai 200. Sehingga degradasi selulosa, hemiselulosa, lignin itu akan kelihatan di sini sampai kepada terakhir akan jadi abu. Ini sangat menarik sekali. Ya, sangat menarik sekali kita menguji karbon aktif gunakan dengan TGA. Hanya saja hanya beberapa perguruan tinggi yang ada di Indonesia yang mengenai TGA, ya. Kemudian yang kedua adalah nitrogen absorption dissolved isothermal, ya, gas analyzer analisis, ya, apa namanya, GSA, ya. Ini apa gunanya alat itu? Alat ini menentukan berapa besarnya surface area yang kita lihat, ya, berapa besarnya surface area yang kita dapat. Nanti dari surface area itu pun kita tahu bagaimana bentuk porinya, bagaimana bentuk pore volume-nya, ya, pore size distribution-nya, kita bisa melihat. Ya, jadi itu memang alat ini sangat penting sekali kita miliki. Alhamdulillah UII telah miliki ini, gas absorption analyzer, Quantachrome, ya, Quantachrome. Kalau dulu saya ini menggunakan micrometis, ya. Nah, kita menggunakan Quantachrome. Jadi seperti ini kita melihat. Ini adalah nitrogen absorption dissolution isothermal. Ya, perbedaan temperatur itu sangat jelas sekali. Ya, temperatur lebih tinggi dan lebih rendah dan lebih tinggi akan terbentuk pembukaan pori. Jadi di sini akan kelihatan pori-porinya berupa kombinasi antara mikro dan meso dengan histeresis 4, ya, tipe 4 begitu. Jadi kita gunakan gas absorption analysis sangat penting sekali. Secara umum kita gunakan seperti itu. Kemudian ada lagi SEM, ya, scanning electron micro. Kita melihat bagaimana struktur pori, ya, di dalam di permukaan itu. Jadi kita bisa melihat struktur pori, bisa kita melihat pori apa namanya, permukaannya itu kasar, smooth atau tidak. Ya, jadi kita akan melihat seperti ini. Dengan menggunakan EDS juga kita akan mengetahui komponen komposisi daripada karbon aktif. Jadi ini empat tiga. Yang keempat itu adalah ini, ya. Yang keempat itu adalah FTIR untuk menentukan surface area. Nah, minimal student kita itu, ya, di tempat saya itu, mahasiswa saya itu saya arahkan ke ini semua. Ini minimal mereka memiliki struktur seperti ini. Nah, sekarang new performance of the atypical carbon. Ya, jadi kalau kita bicara tentang atypical carbon, kalau kita mau mengembangkannya lagi, maka yang perlu kita lihat pertama adalah tentukan dulu raw materialnya. Ya, we hope we have high carbonaceous material. Ya, kita berharap kita memiliki kandungan carbonaceous, karbonnya, kandungan karbon itu tinggi. Ya, sehingga kita ketika kita mau merubah material menjadi karbon aktif, memiliki gugus fungsi yang bagus, memiliki luas permukaan yang bagus, pore size distribution yang bagus, pore volume yang bagus, maka itu baru kita kembangkan menjadi nano komposit. Nah, itu jadi step-nya itu sangat baik. Ya, step-nya itu. Meskipun karbon aktif ini bisa diaplikasikan nano komposit, juga bisa kita aplikasikan kepada yang lain. Nah, apa yang perlu kita amati di situ? Yang pertama metoda, ya, metoda pyrolysis atau physical chemical aktivasi menggunakan seperti ini. Ada microwave, tadi sudah dikatakan ada microwave, bisa juga kita gunakan. Ada hydrothermal proses, ya, pembuatan obatnya. Kemudian yang perlu kita desain lagi, kita harus mendesain pore structure-nya yang meliputi surface area, pore size distribution, pore volume. Jadi kita sudah mendesain itu. Kita mau mengharapkan kalau bisa ini surface area-nya higher than 1000 atau 2000. Kemudian kita desain port distribusinya semua memiliki mikropori, dominan mikropori, atau kita mengharapkan mesopori, ya seperti itu. Jadi kita memang perlu try and error lah ya di banyak penelitiannya itu untuk mendapatkan port structure yang baik. Kemudian termasuk modifikasi functional group, ya kita modifikasi functional group. Nah jadi itu kemudian baru kita menggunakan modified dengan menggunakan apa, ya. Nah ini adalah yang pernah kita lakukan. Kita melihat di sini, ini adalah karbon aktif, ya. There is no metal inside. Tidak ada gugus metal yang ada nempel di sini. Tetapi di sini adalah ada Fe34, ya. Fe34. Ini karbon aktifnya terbuat dari tandan pisang, banana fruit bunch, ya, tandan pisang. Jadi Fe34. Jadi ini mempunyai magnetic properties, ya. Jadi pada penelitian ini kita menggunakan itu kita tarik dulu dengan magnetik, ya, baru kita tambahkan ke dalam tetrabatik karbon. Kemudian ini juga begitu zinc Al2O3 dengan menggunakan banana pisang, ya, tanaman pisang, ya, kita gunakan seperti itu. Jadi ada kombinasi bimetalik, ya, bimetalik. Nah sejauh ini yang ini kita gunakan sebagai wastewater treatment, ya, wastewater treatment. Kemudian ini juga terbuat dari tanaman kelapa sawit, ya, kelapa sawit. Kita melihat seperti bunga. Jadi ini adalah pori-porinya. Ketika tambahkan dengan Al2O3, indah sekali seperti bunga ini, ya, kita melihat. Ini kita gunakan untuk mengabsorpsi rhodamin B dan sangat bagus sekali. Dan kita bisa mempelajari mekanisme reaction antara asorbat sama asorbat melalui kinetik dan melalui isotermal Langmuir dan Freundlich-nya. Ya, jadi ini sudah kita proses. Dan yang lain juga NiO, ya, NiO, ya, nickel oxide, ya, seperti ini. Dan itu juga ada ini Fe3 dengan tetrabatik karbon dari kelapa sawit. Nah, jadi ini perlu kita desain. Oke, sekarang kita melihat modifikasi teknik to functional carbon adsorbent. Jadi kalau kita melihat di sini, di karbon aktif yang boleh dikatakan kena prosesnya high temperature, some of the functional group release, lepas, ya. Jadi kita perlu menambahkan bahan kimia untuk menimbulkan kembali gugus fungsinya. Jadi dengan seperti reaksi seperti ini, dia akan menghasilkan gugus OH, OH, ada COOH, ada CO, ada CO seperti ini, ya. Jadi kita kembalikan gugus fungsinya. Sama seperti ini semua, ada CN, ya, dengan amino, dengan NH3, dengan asam nitrat, dengan HCN, kita akan kembalikan kembali gugus fungsinya. Ada CN, ada NH2, NH dan sebagainya. Termasuk juga begitu. Kenapa? Karena a functional group is very important for adsorption process. They try to make coordination complex with the metal. Dia akan membentuk reaksi dengan ikatan koordinasi kompleks, ya, seperti itu. Jadi surface complex section, ya, pembentukan senyawa kompleks, ikatan koordinasi. Itu dengan apa? Dengan menggunakan gugus fungsi, ya. Adanya electrostatic interaction, ya, kalau kita mau menyerap, letakkanlah mau menyerap rhodamin B, maka ada electronic interaction. Jadi N plus dari N min, ya, itu akan ada di sini reaksinya. Ada ion exchange dan sebagainya. Jadi begitu pentingnya functional group di dalam new performance of tetrabatik karbon. Beberapa penelitian lain dari jurnal yang saya ambil itu, ya, seperti senyawa karbon, ya, saya fokus pada tetrabatik karbon. Ada grafen, ada nanotube, ya, semua ada senyawa karbon. Fokus pada tetrabatik karbon. Jadi penambahan NO3, H2SO4 itu menghasilkan gugus karboksilat, ya, menghasilkan karboksilat. Sehingga karbon aktif yang di sini menghasilkan gugus karboksilat. Yang semulanya, ya, the tetrabatik karbon doesn't have functional group of the carboxylic acid. Dia tidak memiliki good fungsi ini, maka kita desain untuk bentuk itu. Dan berbagai metode ya, ada dengan microwave excited ya, HNO3 dan sebagainya, sehingga kita menghasilkan lagu fungsi ini. Kemudian contoh lain ya, sama ya seperti itu, dia bisa kita mendesain karbon aktif ini dengan berbagai macam gugus fungsi yang ada di situ. Nah, karena kalau kita berinteraksi antara absorben itu ya, ini akan terbentuk suatu kompleksasi ya, bentuk senyawa kompleks melalui koordinasi kompon. Jadi karbon aktif itu ada di sini, gugus fungsinya ada di sini ya, gugus fungsinya ada di sini, sehingga bagaimana interaksi logam sama gugus fungsi ya, ikatan koordinasi dan sebagainya, termasuk dari karbosilik ini pembentukan interaksi V-V bonding ya. Ya, kemudian ada aldehid, ada keton, semuanya. Jadi sangat penting selain daripada pore structure tadi, ya, surface area, pore volume atau pore size distribution, jadi gugus fungsi itu merupakan sangat penting. Nah, penelitian yang saya kembangkan sekarang itu adalah menggunakan nickel oxide dengan Cu oxide, copper. Jadi the conversion of antibody carbon into composite such as antibody carbon metal ion may improve the chemical and physical properties of the composite. Jadi sangat penting sekali. Antibody carbon sendiri itu sudah bagus, tetapi kita improve their properties ya, dengan mengembangkan menggunakan logam. Kemudian nickel copper are widely used in numerous application due to their good catalytic, electronic, and magnetic properties. Ini beberapa alasan yang saya kembangkan itu. Ada combination of the NiCu to build up metallic or alloy form. Ya, bentuk satu alloy. Kemudian baru kita kembangkan, kita interaksikan dia dengan menggunakan karbon aktif. Nah, metodenya mungkin saya singkat saja, metodenya tidak begitu apa, nanti bisa kalau ingin ditanyakan bisa langsung saja waktu lain gitu ya. Jadi antibody karbon sudah dibuat dengan menggunakan impregnasi H3PO4 atau yang lain. Kemudian temperatur tidak begitu tinggi, digunakan 400 tapi dengan menggunakan hidrotermal proses. Ya, dengan hidrotermal. Jadi tidak perlu temperatur tinggi sekali. Kemudian terbentuklah karbon aktif, kemudian dibentuk CuSO4 dengan NiSO4 ya. Kemudian menggunakan temperatur juga tidak terlalu tinggi, 300 dengan hidrotermal, maka terbentuklah alloy form ya, kemudian baru ditambahkan dengan karbon aktif ya, sehingga terbentuklah NCO CuO karbon aktif. Nah, karakterisasi yang telah kita lakukan itu ternyata bahwa ketika karbon aktif itu memang spesifik surface area-nya tidak begitu besar. 85.4 pangkat meter pangkat 2 per gram. Tapi ketika ditambahkan dengan ini meningkat menjadi 496 sekian. Jadi kenaikan surface area dengan menggunakan logam itu sangat signifikan sekali, ya, sangat signifikan sekali. Kemudian dari absorpsi nitrogen absorption disorption-nya itu tipe 4 ya, dengan predominantly mesopore structure. Ya, jadi ini kalau kita ukur dengan menggunakan GSA BGH ya, Brunet Joiner Helenda metode untuk menentukan mesoporenya. Kemudian SEM IDX yang kita peroleh seperti gini ya. Jadi karbonnya 65 konsentrasinya sekitar segini ya. Jadi kita melihat beberapa komponen yang ada di dalam karbon aktifnya, tetapi setelah ditambah dengan Ni akan terbentuk seperti ini ya. Jadi Cu sama Ni-nya dapat sekitar 12 sekian sampai 9 sekian. Jadi komposisinya seperti itu ya, sudah dapat oksigen, dapat karbon. Jadi boleh kita katakan bahwa gugus fungsinya hanya memiliki oksigen saja. Ya, dengan XRD ya, ya amorf semua ya, tapi ini memang tidak begitu kelihatan bentuk kristal daripada CuNi-nya ya. Itu karena memang perbandingan ini memang agak rendah waktu itu kita melakukan. Jadi bisa kita kembangkan lagi dengan perbandingan karbon aktif dengan CuNi itu mungkin setara. Ya, ini perbandingan lebih kecil sekali. Nah, proses hydrocracking. Jadi kita bekerja sama dengan laboratorium UGM ya, setelah kita membuat karbon aktif sebagai katalis tadi, maka kita gunakan untuk mendesain membuat apa namanya? Membuat gasolin dari minyak kelapa sawit. Jadi prosesnya seperti ini, ya, minyak kelapa sawit ini katalisnya ada di sini, ya. Ini dipanaskan pada temperatur 650 dengan menggunakan gas hidrogen keluar bentuk gasolin produk. Ya, jadi kita bersama dengan UGM ini. Dan ini produknya, ya, ini minyak kelapa sawit tanpa menggunakan karbon aktif. Jadi minyak kelapa sawit saja yang kita hydrocracking, kita panaskan, hasilnya seperti ini. Ini menggunakan karbon aktif tanpa katalis, tanpa NiCu. Ini menggunakan dengan NiCu. Bentuk warna yang sangat signifikan perbedaannya. Ya. Nah, hasilnya, ya, hasilnya ini adalah tanpa katalis, ya. Jadi retention time-nya itu di atas 10, ya. Peak-nya cukup banyak sekali di sini, di atas 10. Ya. Jadi kemudian yang menggunakan karbon aktif akan lihat variabel lebih bervariasi. Ya, lebih variasi bentuknya di sini. Ya. Kemudian dengan menggunakan katalis, nah bentuknya seperti ini. Jadi gasoline itu sudah ada di sini. Ya, sudah ada. Ya, jadi memang kalau kita mengamatinya ada suatu perubahan yang sangat signifikan, tapi memang ini penelitian ini masih skala kecil, ya. Jadi kita belum mendapatkan hasil yang sangat maksimal, tapi yang jelas bahwa sudah ada suatu perubahan bahwa katalis itu NiCu atau bari karbon itu sebagai new carbon itu telah memberikan suatu hal yang sangat positif untuk membentuk gasolinnya. Kemudian ini hasilnya, ya, jadi kita gunakan GCMS, ya, jadi senyawa tanpa katalis itu ini tidak ada, tapi dengan katalis itu ada heptana, 1 oktena dan seterusnya sampai sini, tapi CuNi di sini yang mana persen area menggunakan katalis itu jauh lebih besar daripada menggunakan karbon aktif. Jadi artinya bahwa hasilnya lebih bagus. Ya. Kemudian saya juga melakukan proses isomerisasi yang menggunakan normal heksan. Ya, ini normal heksan dengan gisi. Kemudian kita gisi MS dapatkan seperti ini. Ya, hasilnya. Ya. Hasilnya seperti ini. Jadi ada tanpa menggunakan katalis ini, ya. Tapi setelah kita gunakan katalis, ya, nah ini kita gunakan katalis, ada perubahan di mana akan terbentuk senyawa baru isomer, ya, sampai kepada bentuk metil siklopenten, ya, ini ada 1 heksen, ya, dari normal heksan, ya, dari normal heksan. Ada satu yang sangat menarik. Jadi inilah proses-proses yang kita lakukan dengan menggunakan katalis itu. Nah, memang ini hasilnya masih belum maksimal, ya, tapi ini kita masih uji coba terus. Mudah-mudahan nanti ini kalau bisa kita proses lebih baik akan menghasilkan yang lebih baik. Nah, serta itu, ya, yang dapat saya sampaikan. I think that's all my presentation. The conclusion, modification of antibody carbon to new performance may improve the physical and chemical properties, including surface area, pore distribution, pore volume, surface functional group, metallic loading, mono or many or bimetallic catalyst. Jadi banyak digunakan. And new performance catalyst promise multi application for the future life. Jadi ini bisa kita kembangkan, ya, tidak hanya NiCuO, tapi we can improve another metal, ya. Yeah, can be used for other application like a medical sensor or capacitor and etc. Okay, thank you. I think it doesn't matter what you know until you know what matter is the same with sustainability. Thank you very much for your attention. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Saya kembalikan ke Pak Bayu.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you very much, Dr. Alwar, for the excellent presentation. For the discussion, we have already question for Mr. Alwar. From Bapak Darwanta. From Bapak Darwanta, ini beliau menyampaikan apakah ukuran polikarbon aktif bisa dikontrol? Jika bisa, bagaimana caranya? Silakan Pak Alwar.
Ya, sebenarnya untuk mengontrol karbon pori itu ya itu memang sulit ya, memang sulit sekali. Jadi kita tidak bisa mengontrol secara detail ya. Tetapi kita bisa mengusahakan dengan variasi temperatur, dengan variasi kandungan kimia. Jadi umpamanya kita coba trial and error memang yang sudah saya lakukan. Kita start from 500 degrees, 500 derajat. Naikkan 600, naikkan 700, naikkan sampai 800. Sehingga dari hasil itu nanti kita bisa menyimpulkan, oh ternyata bahan ini adalah menggunakan temperatur ini cocoknya gini. Termasuk impregnasi materialnya, ya. Jadi seperti itu. Jadi tidak ada satu metode, oh dengan menggunakan temperatur sekian, bahannya sekian, dia akan memiliki mikro. Tidak bisa. Karena kandungan raw material itu berbeda setiap daerah. Jadi umpamanya karbon aktif dari tumpurung kelapa sawit yang kita ambil di Pekanbaru atau di Riau itu akan berbeda hasilnya dengan yang ada di Thailand atau di Malaysia. Tapi kita menggunakan variasi temperatur atau chemical agent-nya sehingga kita akan dapat sesuai dengan mana yang kita inginkan. Seperti itu, Pak.
Baik, Pak Luar. Jadi apa namanya untuk ukuran pori itu, untuk ukuran pori dari karbon aktif sendiri itu sangat dipengaruhi oleh asal dari raw materialnya sendiri dan juga dari proses pada saat sintesisnya ya Pak ya?
Betul sekali. Ya. Okay. Karena sifatnya sangat natural ya.
Baik, ya. Sifatnya natural, baik. Kami persilakan kepada Bapak Ibu peserta webinar hari ini untuk bisa menyampaikan pertanyaannya. Mungkin ini kami masih memiliki waktu. Jadi mungkin bisa disampaikan secara langsung kepada Dr. Alwar terkait materi yang telah beliau sampaikan. Baik, mungkin sembari menunggu dari Bapak-Ibu semua pertanyaannya, kalau untuk karbon aktif sendiri, Pak, untuk sumbernya itu sendiri yang sudah Pak Alwar lakukan dan juga sudah dari hasil review dari jurnal-jurnal gitu ya. Itu kalau yang paling baik itu dari mana Pak sumbernya Pak untuk pemproduksi karbon aktif?
Ya, yang paling baik itu baru kita dapat dari tumpurung kelapa sawit ya, palm oil cell. itu yang baru kita peroleh. Tapi memang kita memang perlu mengetahui ini fungsinya untuk apa dulu. Ya, fungsinya untuk apa dulu? Jadi kalau umpamanya kita bisa menggunakan, umpamanya gini, palm oil cell itu, tempurung kelapa sawit itu very hard, sangat keras sekali, ya. Sehingga untuk pemberian karbon aktif dia akan memiliki surface area porinya yang sangat bagus, kuat. Definisi maksudnya kuat porinya itu adalah pori itu ketika dimasukkan gas nitrogen, ketika kita menggunakan analisis, dia tidak pecah, dia tidak wrinkle, mengkerut. Ya, sehingga ketika nitrogen itu masuk ke dalam dan keluar lagi itu tidak akan membuat perubahan apa-apa. Sehingga pori-pori ini sangat baik sekali. Nah, itu. Tapi kita bisa juga membuat karbon aktif dari umpamanya yang karbonnya kandungannya kecil sekali, ya. Seperti dari tandan pisang saja. Ya, tandan pisang. Itu juga bisa, hasilnya juga bagus. Kita sudah coba kan gunakan juga untuk absorpsi methylene blue, kemudian absorpsi rabin B, hasilnya sangat bagus. Kita bisa melihat bagaimana reaksinya. Ya, Wainwright Haas untuk mengabsorpsi logam, ya kita sudah lakukan juga. Ya, hasilnya juga bagus. Jadi, tapi kalau mau kita compare hasilnya, memang karbon dari palm oil cell yang lebih bagus, terasa.
Baik. Berarti sejauh ini yang sudah Pak Alwar lakukan di tim riset juga untuk palm oil cell masih yang memiliki karakteristik yang paling baik ya Pak ya untuk adsorben maupun untuk katalis sendiri. Baik, ini ada pertanyaan lagi Pak Alwar.
Ya.
Dari Pak Darwanta, masih dari Pak Darwanta. Apakah pernah melakukan scale up proses membuat karbon aktif?
keadaan terakhir pernah memproses berapa berat yang dihasilkan dan apakah scale up kualitasnya tetap terjaga?
Ya, jadi kita yang terakhir ini saya tidak menggunakan karena TGA kita sangat sulit ya. Jadi kalau sebelumnya kita menggunakan, jadi kalau karbon aktif itu dari tempurung kelapa sawit kita bisa memperoleh 40% kandungan karbon aktif karbonnya. Ya, karbon itu sangat tergantung kepada karbonnya. Jadi kalau kita pyrolisis raw materialnya letakkanlah 100 gram, maka sekitar 40 atau 35% kita dapat karbon aktifnya. Selebihnya itu adalah es ya, abu. Tapi kalau kemarin saya juga mengujakan dengan TGA. Itu sebenarnya TGA itu pentingnya di situ. Dengan tandan kosong kelapa sawit. Ya, kita dapat hanya sekitar 20 sampai 25%. Ya, karena dia lembut. Ya, dia lembut. Jadi lebih banyak dia menghasilkan abu. Ya, banyak menghasilkan abu. Oleh sebab itu tuh, ya, nitrogen itu sangat penting sekali untuk menghindari terbentuknya abu itu. Ya, menghindari itu. Nah, tapi saya waktu itu membuatnya paling dapat paling tinggi menggunakan itu sekitar 2400 pangkat 2 gram per meter per gram itu ya luas permukaannya. Kemudian saya coba lagi, nah kita tidak dapat sebanyak itu. Jadi memang agak sulit kita dalam menentukan karena dia sangat natural sekali. Ya sangat natural sekali. Nah, gitu. Jadi scale up kalau di selama ini saya menggunakan ketika sudah di sini kita TGA-nya agak kurang ya. Tidak punya TGA. Ataupun kalau ada sangat mahal sekali. Jadi sehingga saya tidak menentukan berapa kandungan karbonnya yang ada di dalam karbon aktif itu. Padahal itu sangat penting sekali sebenarnya. Itu kira-kira.
Oke, baik. Berarti memang apa namanya karakteristik dari raw materialnya dulu ya, Pak. Tadi memang yang palm oil shell karena dia memang cukup kuat dari raw materialnya sendiri, makanya dia rendemen yang hasilkan juga cukup besar ya Pak ya.
Ya.
Dibandingkan dengan yang tadi apa yang raw material yang lainnya. Baik Pak Luar. Ini masih ada lagi Pak pertanyaan dari Bapak ya, Bapak atau Ibu nih mungkin ya, Utrika dari Universitas Ibrahimi. Pertanyaan adalah saat modifikasi gugus fungsi, apakah tidak memungkinkan akan ada gugus fungsi yang mendominasi? Dan bagaimana efektivitas karbon aktifnya? Mungkin setelah ada modifikasi dari karbon aktifnya, apakah ada gugus fungsi yang mendominasi, Pak? Dan efektivitas dari karbon aktifnya setelah dimodifikasi itu bagaimana?
Ya, karbon aktif yang kita buat, karbon aktif itu biasanya yang selalu ada itu adalah oksigen. Ya, selalu ada itu oksigen. Jadi kalau dia kandungan oksigen itu macam-macam dari OHK dari karboksilat atau lakton atau keton itu yang kebanyakan seperti itu ya. Kemudian kena pengaruh temperatur yang sangat tinggi hanya kandungan sedikit atau bahkan tidak ada gugus fungsi yang lain. Maka kita perlu mendesainnya itu. Nah, itu saya katakan tadi itu ya. Kita mau mendesain seperti apa? Ya. Yang mendominasi dari awal saya rasa tidak. Ya. Tapi mensupport iya, ya mensupport iya, ya. Jadi kita kan mengharapkan gugus fungsi itu adalah gugus fungsi yang memiliki lone pair elektron, ya, memiliki lone pair elektron yang kita tambahkan ke sana, karena akan membentuk suatu interaksi dengan coordination bonding nantinya, untuk ikatan koordinasi. Sehingga itu yang kita tambahkan ke dalam karbon aktif itu. Sekarang kita ingin mau masukkan yang mana? Nah, itu tergantung kepada kita. Ya, seperti proses tadi itu saya sudah sampaikan tadi prosesnya. Masih bisa lihat punya saya nih, Pak?
Masih, Pak.
Lihat saya?
Ya, masih, Pak.
Masih lihat. Nah, seperti gini kan, ya. Ini karbon aktifnya. Kalau kita mau menambahkan amino, ya. Saya pernah menambahkan dengan urea. Akan membentuk satu N.
Ya. Mungkin slide-nya berbeda, Pak Alwan. Ini masih slide yang nomor 2, Pak.
Hah? Ini?
Iya, ini masih slide yang kedua. Belum.
Bukan, ini bukan. Bukan, belum belum ini. Kan
ini masih belum bergerak, Pak, slide-nya, Pak. Masih belum, masih tetap di slide yang kedua.
Okay. Ini sudah?
Oke, Pak, sudah, Pak. Siap.
Ya. Jadi, ini kita lihat ini, ya. Nitrogen. Ya, we are going to add nitrogen functional group on the atmospheric carbon surface. Ya, kita akan mencoba menambahkan nitrogen ini ke dalam ke permukaannya. Tambahkan nih, nambah asam amino, nambah asam nitrat, ya, urea, macam-macam. Sehingga akan terbentuklah suatu gugus fungsi yang seperti ini. Begitu juga yang lainnya, ya, begitu juga yang lainnya. Nah itu, jadi yang biasanya karbon aktif yang ada di dalam dalam karbon aktif itu sendiri itu biasanya adalah yang umum. Nah, seperti gini. Ya. Nah, ini kan berasal dari raw materialnya. Ya, raw materialnya. Ada O, ada ini semua. Jadi yang dominan itu ada seperti ini. Nanti ada acid surface sama base, ya. Tapi ini bisa hilang jika proses hidrolisisnya itu digunakan pada temperatur yang sangat tinggi. Nah, itu yang jadi oleh sebab itu kita mendesain kembali dengan menggunakan gugus fungsi ini. Jadi saya pernah menggunakan dengan urea dengan massa nitrat akan timbul suatu gugus fungsi N. Nah, N itu memiliki lone pair elektron yang sangat penting sekali dalam mereaksikan senyawa organik atau anorganik. Mengabsorpsi senyawa organik dan anorganik. Gitu kira-kira, Pak.
Oke, baik. Berarti kalau untuk ini, Pak, apa namanya tadi juga pertanyaan dari Pak atau Ibu Udrikanya itu, kalau terkait dengan efektivitas dari karbon aktifnya setelah dimodifikasi lebih baik dari yang tanpa modifikasi atau bagaimana, Pak?
Iya. Jadi gini, kalau kita menggunakan karbon aktif sebagai penyerap air, ya, pemuni air, barangkali kita tidak memerlukan begitu gugus fungsinya, ya, tidak begitu dominan kebutuhan dari gugus fungsi, tidak begitu dominan tanda-tanya, ya. Nah, gitu. Tapi kalau kita menggunakan karbon itu sebagai penyerap polutan, nah, ya, polutan, maka kita harus mendesain porinya, kita desain, ya. Kalau dia polutannya seperti apa? Ya, mikro kah, meso kah, kemudian polutan juga seperti apa, maka kita desain gugus fungsinya. Ya, jadi jadi tujuannya untuk meningkatkan efektivitas daripada karbon aktif itu. Tapi kalau dia hanya sekedar untuk menyerap air, apalagi airnya sudah bersih, ya, sudah air bersih, kita gunakan karbon aktif biar lebih bagus kualitasnya, itu kita barangkali tidak begitu memikirkan tentang gugus fungsi. Tapi kalau dia itu limbah industri, maka gugus fungsi itu jadi bagian hal yang sangat penting. Jadi sudah pasti efektivitas daripada karbon aktif itu akan lebih baik, ya. Termasuk nanti di dalam aplikasi-aplikasi lain, ya, itu juga akan meningkatkan efektivitasnya. Itu kira-kira, Pak Bayu.
Baik, terima kasih Pak Alwar. Ini pertanyaan dan jawaban yang sangat menarik untuk diskusinya. Baik, saya mungkin dari Bapak Ibu masih ada lagi yang ingin disampaikan kepada pemateri kita, Pak Alwar. Baik, kalau tidak ada, mungkin untuk sesi ini kami cukupkan. Terima kasih sekali lagi kepada Dr. Alwar. Oh, ada satu, Pak. Ternyata, Pak, menyusul, Pak.
Oke, ya.
Oh, dari Ibu Winda Apriani, Poltesa Sambas. Kebetulan beliau adalah alumni dari Teknik Kimia UII, mau bertanya. Oh, di walau untuk di MIPA UII atau di UII secara umumnya itu instrumen apa saja ya, Pak, yang bisa digunakan untuk dalam hal pengujian karbon aktif?
Oke. Jadi di MIPA itu sekarang kita sudah punya program S2. Ya, kimia S2 sudah punya. Dilengkapi dengan laboratorium yang sudah cukup komplit untuk khususnya untuk material sains, ya, khususnya material sains apalagi karbon aktif. Jadi kita sudah punya gas Sorption Analyzer, GSA, kita sudah punya. Tadi kita untuk menentukan berapa luas permukaan, bentuk pori, itu sudah punya. Kita sudah punya SEM EDX, EDS ya. Kita tahu bagaimana bentuk permukaan daripada karbon aktif itu. Ya, jadi ini mensupport kalau mahasiswa-mahasiswa kita yang mau berbicara tentang nanomaterial. Kemudian kita punya EDX, XRD. Jadi kalau tadi kita gunakan karbon aktif saja, tadi saya waktu tadi menangkan general karakterisasi itu tidak menggunakan XRD. Ya. Kenapa? Karena karbon aktif itu sudah terbentuk, kita cuci dengan bahan kimia nitrat contohnya, maka tidak ada lagi logam. Kita nggak perlu gunakan XRD. Karena karbon aktif itu sudah pasti dia amorf. Ya. Tapi ketika kita mereaksikan dengan metal, ya kita jadikan immobile karbon aktif itu dengan metal, maka kita perlu gunakan XRD. Seberapa baikkah metal itu nempel dari karbon aktif itu? Atau adakah interaksinya? Kita lihat level kristalisasinya bisa kita lihat. Jadi kita punya XRD di sini, ya. Nah, kalau umpamanya ada yang tertarik untuk menganalisis, mungkin silakan gabung ke lab kimia, ya. Insya Allah itu bisa kita support. Kalau untuk aplikasinya kita juga sudah punya AAS, ya. Kalau mau aplikasikan untuk mengabsorpsi logam, maka berapa banyak logam yang akan diabsorpsi kita bisa menggunakan AAS. Ada juga RPLC, kita juga punya kan gas atau UV fish, ya. Jadi insya Allah sudah cukup lah di sini untuk itu. Tapi kalau TGA tadi kita belum punya, ya. TGA itu sangat penting sekali. Atau kalau mau tambah lagi dengan gunakan TEM, ya, itu akan lebih bagus lagi seperti itu.
Oke, baik Pak Luar. Jadi itu Bu jawaban dari Pak Luar. Jadi jika insya Allah kalau untuk instrumentasi untuk karakterisasi terkait dengan karbon aktif gitu ya, insya Allah fasilitas di UII itu sudah mampu gitu ya. Mungkin tadi hanya kurang beberapa instrumen saja untuk melengkapi. Jadi monggo, kalau tadi pertanyaan dari Ibu Widinda, jadi jika ingin analisis gitu ya, menggunakan analisis karbon aktif gitu ya, mungkin penelitiannya sama dengan Pak Alwar, monggo bisa sampelnya mungkin bisa dikirimkan, nanti bisa melihat di webnya lab terpadu Bu gitu ya. Jadi nanti bisa informasinya ada di sana untuk terkait dengan analisis sampel. Baik, mungkin untuk sesi ini kami cukupkan Bapak Ibu. Terima kasih sekali lagi kepada Dr. Alwar untuk presentasinya yang luar biasa dan juga atas jawaban-jawabannya. To all participants, maybe this is the end of the session from this webinar. From me as a moderator, maybe there are mistaken in delivering the session. Hopefully there is many regret from all the participants. The room is back to the host, Professor Is Fatima.
Terima kasih Pak Bayu, Pak Alwar, PhD atas pemaparan materinya pada sesi yang kedua ini. Ladies and gentlemen, terima kasih atas perhatian. Unfortunately, Prof. Ramis and Prof. Rui have left this meeting because they have another meeting for today. Jadi terima kasih sekali sekali lagi atas paparan dari kedua pemateri. Dan sebagai apresiasi dari jurusan kimia, kami menghaturkan banyak terima kasih. Jadi, this certificate has been delivered to Professor Insinyur Dr. Ramis Singh from University Teknologi Malaya. Dan juga kami sampaikan sertifikat untuk Dr. Alwar, MSc, PhD atas pemaparan yang menarik juga kaitannya dengan bagaimana penelitian riset material di UII. Gitu. Jadi untuk agenda hari ini, kita telah mendapatkan informasi yang berkaitan dengan penelitian material, utamanya adalah bioseramik, ya, material yang sangat penting bagi dunia kesehatan, dan barangkali ini juga akan menjadi inspirasi untuk penelitian-penelitian kita berikutnya. dan juga pemaparan dari Pak Alwar kaitannya dengan potensi nanokomposit dari karbon aktif untuk aplikasi katalis dalam penyediaan energi. Dan terima kasih juga kami ucapkan kepada Pak Bayu Wiantoko, MSc, atas moderator yang sangat menarik dan interaktif, juga kepada Bapak-Ibu peserta semuanya. Dan karena ini adalah bagian dari webinar series dari jurusan Kimia FMIPA UII, kami juga mengundang acara webinar berikutnya yang insya Allah akan diselenggarakan pada tanggal 21 September 2020, mulai pukul 9 sampai pukul 12. Dan acara ini free, ya, termasuk free registration untuk semua peserta, baik dari UII maupun dari luar UII, dengan tema Role of Chemistry for Sustainable Energy and Environment, menghadirkan pembicara kita, world class profesor dari National Tsinghua University Taiwan, Prof. Rui Andong, dan juga dari Universitas Riau, Profesor Dr. Titania Nugroho, serta nanti akan dibuka oleh Bapak Dekan Prof. Rianto serta Ketua Departemen, Ketua Program Studi Magister Kimia, Bapak Dr. Andes Alwar, MSc PhD, bagi Bapak-Ibu yang tertarik untuk mengikuti semua peserta, mahasiswa UII maupun di luar UII, silakan bergabung dengan mengklik bit.ly/sg_magister_1. Silakan melakukan registrasi sebelum registrasi kami tutup karena keterbatasan kuota. Dan untuk acara hari ini, alhamdulillah kita sudah melakukan dokumentasi, insya Allah akan segera kami share lewat chatbox itu. Dan juga untuk peserta yang telah melakukan registrasi dengan request sertifikat, Bapak Ibu dapat mendownload melalui tautan berikut yang sebentar lagi juga akan kami sampaikan melalui chat. Demikian informasi yang bisa kami sampaikan. Sampai jumpa pada acara webinar series berikutnya. Sekian, assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam. Waalaikumsalam. Terima kasih Prof. Is.
Sama-sama Pak Komar. Ya.
Thank you. Terima kasih Bapak Ibu. Saya tutup Zoom meetingnya, nggih.
Oke. Okay.